First show in New York, the Whitney Museum in 1970, the barbed wire things.
Wow.
And that sort of catalog. That was relatively the most recent very large piece in Lafayette, Eastern Pennsylvania, Lafayette College. Well, that one you saw. This was that one in the studio fabricating. And that's how it is at the library, where it is.
Oh,
yeah, these are same piece, just other photographs that I took.
Details, yeah.
Yeah. And I think, yeah. That's Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. And this way you don't have to use any of this, but you told me, you sent me an email, so this is what you get.
No, this is what you, oh my God, look at that.
That's great. This was the photo for the poster for my first one-man show at Santa Barbara in 65. This is taken at the show in Santa Barbara in 65. That's Rani, you're talking about Rani? That's Rani in 65 at my opening. That's me. That's talking about Chouinard history. Herb Jepson, who was one of the teachers. Jepson and D'Erdely and LeBrun had a school at one point. I think it was Jepson's school, but they were the principals. This is Edmund Cohn, who's a painter brother who taught at Chouinard, and his brother was a sculptor, Gabriel Cohn, who showed at David, what's his name's gallery on?
David Stewart.
For years. The painter who painted Money, Bob O'Dowd.
Yeah.
That's Bob, he was.
Yeah,
he was a friend. The show that I organized in San Bernardino, he was one of the artists in it. Yeah, this is architect Marion Sampler. He worked for Victor Gruen or one of those. Yeah, this is the artist and editor for Art Forum, Arthur Secunda. So that's Arthur. He was at the opening.
Do you get his newsletter?
Every now and then I get something from him. Yeah. Oh yeah. We were good friends. In fact, you could say he was part of the reason I had that show at Santa Barbara, because he knew people up there. He knew. This is a painter here in LA named Bill Brune, who had a one-man show at the Pasadena Museum in the 60s, a real colorist as an artist. This is Marvin Harden, the painter who went to UCLA, showed at CJ, and a lot of places, got a Guggenheim and all that. Went to UCLA with Lloyd Hamrell and all of those people, Marv's still up in Cambria, California and stuff. And And he's very good artist. We played football together and stuff, but he went off to UCLA and I went to SC. This is Irene Hadishi, I think. Who's the wife of Nob Hadishi, if you know him. They're close friends of Connor Everts, but they were at my show. And these are pictures at the show. And, so various members of, And don't tell me they didn't show them, because they didn't. That was the first time somebody else hung my Lynch fragments. So when I tell you 69 inches to the hole in the back for the height, don't say, oh no, they didn't do it that way here. This, once they did it wrong.
When you got there,
this is the way.
Big smile on your face.
No, well, yeah, I did. But look, this is way up in the ceiling, and stuff. Benny Andrews, the painter in New York, has that one. But anyway, this one's owned, but I can't remember the collector's name in Santa Barbara.
Bought out of the show?
After the show from Esther Baer, when Esther Baer's gallery and stuff,
Did Harry Drinkwater photograph
him? No, Harry had nothing to do with this. I knew Harry, but we weren't close. He was a close friend of a friend of ours, Bob Rogers, the clothes designer. They were very close, but.
I have been scanning some of Harry's photographs and it looked exactly like.
I got you. No, these are either I took them or somebody I handed my camera to, or Ronnie Miyashiro. But Ronnie's in the picture, so I don't think. But I can't. It's too far back. This one you'll see another version. In this case, it wasn't in a framework, but went ceiling to corner you know, the chain hooks. Whereas later on, I put it in a frame. Yeah, here. This is the County Museum later in that year. And that's that same piece, but in this framework. And it, actually, we're going to show this in my upcoming show, sort of do a little history with that.
Hmm. And that's going to be in Kelly's show too, right?
Not this one, but this one and this one.
And August the Fire.
Yeah, August the Squared Fire and the Lifted X. Kelly didn't express any interest in that. And I said, okay, Kelly don't know. She's been looking at books. She's never seen the real deal. No, I mean, you know, it's understandable when you've seen things like...
It's so different when you see the work and you come to know the work in books and then you experience it.
The real thing, yeah, the real scale, yeah, you know. No, I mean, it's a fine piece. I'm not, you know, that these are two different views of that one. And you was it you who got in touch with... Chicago?
Yes. Yeah. So Afro Phoenix 1.
It is coming?
Yes.
Okay, good. Yeah. Well, this is 2, so anyway. You know, yeah. And this is one of the discs of the fragments which Dr. Banks owns. Homage to my grandfather.
Do you speak with him when you come to LA?
Banks, I'm supposed to go to lunch with him, but I haven't called him to reach him yet. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But I'd love to have his number.
Sure.
I've been trying to reach him, and we were actually at a luncheon, and he was sitting 2 seats away from me, and I didn't realize.
That was him, yeah. This one, my old teacher, Hans Burkhardt, bought for me. But then a couple of years before he passed, he asked me who to give it to, so I had him give it to the Studio Museum in Harlem, you know, so, you know. Okay, so that's all I brought.
Okay,
there's,
well,
you know.
What we're going to do is this, we'll probably scan a few, we'll probably ask you about some of these during the interview,
mm-hmm.
and then we'll probably ask our research assistant who's here mm-hmm. to scan a few of them before you leave.
Mm-hmm. I think this is off. Let me. Okay.
And maybe just for a moment, because we might ask Coke for some money. So.
10%. No problem, 10%.
So it's July 16th, and we're here with artist Mel Edwards and Andrew Perchuk, Rani Singh, myself. And we're being videotaped by Peter Kirby and Morgan Kessler on the occasion of our Pacific Standard Time project. So welcome, Mel. And I just thought we'd start a little bit, but maybe you can tell us a bit about your childhood and growing up in Texas and moving to Ohio.
Oh.
Some of your mm-hmm. you know, first influences of being exposed to art.
Hmm. Well, I was born in Houston, you know, May 4th, 1937. Mama said 1 in the morning or something like that. And that I was a laborious delivery. Anyway, but after I got here, I was a lot of fun. Houston, which is where I was born, you know, is a typical southern city, but it is a port. The port of Houston, it was the second largest in the United States, so it's actually significant. So many of the men who, you know, in or around the family worked in the shipyards or for the oil industry or things like that. And my father was working for, a pipeline or pipe company at the time, which may well have had to do with that. But he had any number of jobs. By the time I was 4, we moved outside of Houston to a little town called McNair, or McNair as we say it, which is really close to Baytown, which is where the Humble Oil Refinery. Humble you'd know now as Exxon or that. It's ultimately was Standard Oil in Texas, but its name was Humble. Excuse me. We lived there a couple of years till I was about 6. My grandfather lived in that town, and he also had worked for that oil company. In fact, he worked till he retired from there. That's my grandfather, James Felton, my mother's father. In 1944, my father, who'd been active in his Houston years, I think he was the founder of the first Black Boy Scout troop in Houston at the Gregg Street Presbyterian Church, which was our family church. My parents went to the same high school, Phyllis Wheatley, which I eventually went to. My parents were evidently good students and good athletes. My mother playing basketball, my father football and track. And so when I went to that high school, eventually I was an athlete. But at the age of 7 in 44, my father was sort of brought into the professional scouting arena, and they sent him to Mendham, New Jersey, to train at the National Training School for Professional Scout Executives. And then his assignment, which started, I think, in about June of 44 in Dayton, Ohio. So we moved to Dayton. The moving to Dayton is eventful in the sense it was during the war. The trains were full of soldiers and that kind of thing. And, you know, I saw soldiers. And I remember changing trains in St. Louis and the dolphins in the fountain, which I didn't know were dolphins until 30 years later when I passed through St. Louis and recognized the fountains, you know. So visual memory has always been a part of things. In terms of when we got to Dayton, we lived there 5 years, age 7 to age 12, or 1944 to 49. Art itself, I always drew and made things and played with knives and sticks. And we used to dig clay from between the houses in Houston, where the rain, I guess, settled there. And somebody knew that the mud underneath there was clay because it was a different color than the other. And we made stuff, you know. And I drew. You know, but like all kids, I don't think I was special, I just did. But in Dayton, in about the fourth or fifth grade, we did have art classes, and we did get sent or taken to the museum, the Dayton Art Institute, which had a little zoo, that is, they had peacocks and deer and other local animals. But then I remember the armor collection. I remember the harpsichord and some what looked like early European, you know, 15th or 16th century European paintings. I can't remember any in particular. More fun was the harpsichord because you weren't supposed to touch it. And I was 10, so we touched it. The guards were all my age now, 70 or older. And they couldn't catch us. So, but I do remember that in one demonstration that a teacher did in terms of drawing, of her using a drawing pencil. I mean, you know, in other words, an art store drawing pencil. And it was a Venus drawing pencil because I remember the green of that. And I remember her trying to draw the foliage of a tree. That's all I remember. Of the museum, you know, or that, but it was fun. In the class at school, the teacher set up this girl named Flora, who was kind of chubby, blonde, and pretty face, and had a pinafore, you know, those kind of ruffled dresses. That's the right name, I think. Yeah. Anyway, somehow my drawing of Flora looked like Flora, which amazed me because, you know, I didn't know anything or I didn't know that you really could do that. That was something somewhere else. So I took drawing a little more seriously, or just like when you're a kid and you can discover you've done something, that you can do something. Most kids in Dayton, as I remember it, who like to draw cartoons. I didn't. I didn't like drawing cartoons. I liked the comic books and stuff, but I didn't like drawing cartoons. I was never attracted to that. In fact, it seemed, in a childish way, corny to me. I don't know why, but that was how it felt. When we got back to Houston when I was 12, in the seventh grade, you had an elective, and I took an art class. And from then on, I always took art in classes and stuff. That was junior high, 7th, 8th, and 9th grade. I'm trying to remember the teacher's name. I don't. Well, anyway. But in high school, my art teacher was Mrs.
Mrs. Bang?
Well, Mrs. Bang was in Ohio.
Okay,
yeah.
Yeah, Sadie Melton.
Sadie Melton was the teacher in junior high school. I did say it. Okay. She was a junior high school art teacher. And I remember because one of the guys in those classes, starting in junior high school, was a man named Willie Jordan. And Willie Jordan is now a well-known Houston architect. So we were classmates and that sort of thing. And at our high school, there was a little architecture program. Mr. Thomas was the teacher of that class. And he'd been a teacher there since the time my parents were there. In fact, any number of teachers were people who had either taught my parents or had gone to school with my parents. So when we were in Houston, when I got back to Phyllis Wheatley High School, that was an environment which was more home than I understood when I got there, you know. But it came pretty clear. Anything I did, the word got home if necessary before I did, you know. Anyway, it was a good high school, very good high school. It still exists and it's grown. And they rebuilt it a couple of times, brand new in 1950. The old school became the junior high school. And then the new school I went to in 52, when I got to high school, was more or less a brand new school facility. Well, about 5 years ago, they rebuilt again, added to that school and redesigned it. And that architect that I mentioned, my classmate, Willie Jordan, was the architect who made the changes for the new school. So it's been that kind of community, though any number of political attempts have been made to wipe out that community and neighborhood. But it's very large, very dynamic, and produced any number of significant people, from Barbara Jordan, the political person, Mickey Leland also, you know, and musicians, doctor, any number of, you know, people that will come to the aid of the school and the community, even though they no longer live there, that kind of thing. So growing up in the Fifth Ward of Houston, Texas, in 1950s, was a continuation of a tradition. And to a significant extent, it still continues. And there's an organization related to that high school here in Los Angeles. And, you know, it continues. My art years at Wheatley High School, Mrs. Ladner, were very good. I have friends who come from that time. But I and one other student from my high school, Joe Lewis Johnson, and four other students, two from each of the other two black high schools, because this is a period of total segregation. So the six of us were given a course at the Houston Museum of Fine Arts. I think it was on Mondays, probably the day the museums closed. And University of Texas graduate student named Vera Jane Tate was a person who ran the class, and we enjoyed the museum. You know, we go around and look at paintings and stuff. And
did you draw from the art.
We did, but we did still lifes and, you know, other projects, but never copied. That never was a part of our development. Everything we did. One of the things our teacher, Mrs. Ladner, encouraged was just draw from your own environment, that kind of thing, in your own world. I mean, we looked at art books and stuff, you know. I liked in particular Renaissance stuff, Da Vinci and Michelangelo, and I think the anatomical thing, the physical interest I had in sports. And that was the kind of thing in the family, because my father was not just athletics, but he'd literally correspondence courses in physical culture, in Swedish massage, you know, things like that. And so those books were around, and curiosity, you know. See, this is all pre-television for the most part. So you found your information wherever you did. The high school library was the strongest library around. The Houston Negro Public Library for Negroes was in a house, and it probably was two stories the size of two of this rooms like this. And I stole two books, Anyone Can Paint and Advice to a Young Artist. Zaydenberg was the author of Anyone Can Paint, and advice to a young artist was Etienne Rit, R-E-T, however the French pronunciation would be of that. That one I still have. The Zaydenberg, somebody stole from me. But I think, I'm pretty sure I still have it. I'm only sorry that I took out the name Houston Colored Public Library, because it would have been documented the nature of the time. But in any case, those were the high school years, and I got very interested in art, you know. My last year in high school, I was an honor roll student. Other years, I was not, you know. I was probably fairly smart, but I wasn't one of the whiz kids, you know. I wasn't one of the ones that automatically, probably I read a lot, but didn't do homework and things like that. So who knows what my level might have been. But sports, art, and I like to read were, I'd say, my focus. I worked from age 14 all the way through high school on Fridays and Saturdays at a local supermarket, El Orlando's supermarket, in the meat department. The first year in the produce department, the second, the next 3 years in the meat department as an assistant to the butchers, which meant you chopped up all the oxtails, you carried in the meat when the trucks came, you know, and stuff like that. The labor, the unskilled stuff, the real butchers who could cut a steak, you know, to any dimension and beautifully and stuff. No, that wasn't. They had real, that was William Bonnie Jackson who could do that, you know. But it was an interesting experience also, because my interest in anatomy, I knew how to cut up a chicken the various ways you do, which means I learned dissection, and I was dissecting chickens, you know, cutting them up. At the same time, I was studying anatomical things, so, you know, it's reciprocal. And I paid attention to that kind of thing, you know. So a lot of things I can now see very logically came together, you know. I mean, you know, I could advise a student, hey, cut up some chickens and draw the parts and open them, you know. Or these days they won't have a whole chicken anywhere, but go to you know, the colonel and order the parts, you know. Or there are live chicken places, you know, and stuff. But anyway, you know.
And what year did you come to Los Angeles?
In 1955. I graduated high school in 1955. In other words, we moved back to Houston in November 11th, 1949. And I left Houston June the 6th, 1955, for L.A.
What caused you to move to
Whatever.
All right, you're on.
In terms of the move to Los Angeles, my aunt and uncle, my aunt Modi Bell Edwards Huddleston, and my uncle Clive Matthew Huddleston lived in L.A. And she was my father's sister, and only sister. And they had no children. And he'd been in the Navy. And when he got out of the Navy, in that period, she joined him in California, you know, because they were married in Texas. And I was, I can't say her favorite nephew, I was her only nephew, you know. So typical of aunts and nephews, I was with her a lot when I was, you know, with them a lot when I was very young. But we went east to Ohio, they went west to California. And we visited them in California in the summer of 1951. My father, when we got back to Texas, was working for the hospital part of the Southern Pacific Railroad. They had a hospital in Houston. And vacation perks was you had free pass for you and the family to go anywhere you wanted. And so his 2 week vacation consisted of 4 days on the Argonaut, which was the slow train from Houston. It started in New Orleans, but from Houston to Los Angeles. and then 4 days back. So that's 8 days of a 14-day. So I guess we were in in LA about 5 days. But it was a nice visit, you know, and of course a different world than Houston and Texas. And I must have expressed that I was a little bit interested in art. And somehow we drove past the Art Center School. And my aunt said, oh, maybe you'd like to go to school here, you know, someday. Well, you know, but that was just a passing thought. And I was back on my way to junior high school and art and stuff. But when it came time to graduate high school, I wanted to go back to Ohio because I missed Ohio. You know, kid, you move from some place as a kid. But nothing was turning out that would be possible. And I had a local football scholarship offers to Prairie View University, which was a very good black school in Texas. But they didn't have an art department. My junior high school basketball coach, because I did play basketball in junior high school. I wasn't very good, but I played. His father was the president of Prairie View A&M University, and he suggested that Prairie View would welcome me there, but I asked about art. He says, well, if you have to do that through the home economics department. So in Houston was Texas Southern University, and John Biggers was teaching there. And that would have made some sense. But in the meantime, my aunt and uncle offered that I could come and live with them, and we'd try to find a way that I could go to college. And so I had joined the Navy Reserves in February of 55. And summer camp came up, and you could choose one of two or three places for your summer 2 weeks training. And so I chose San Diego and took my aunt and uncle up on going to live with them. So that was what happened. I had my first airplane flight, courtesy of Uncle Sam in my Navy uniform, to LA and then San Diego. And then somebody dropped me off in LA at my aunt's after the 2 weeks was up. And so that was how. We figured out that LACC cost $9 a semester, and the $9 was basically an activity fee. And I and many people in LA, that was their way into the university world. And it turned out to be a very good school, and I enjoyed my 2 years there, studied art there. The teachers were basically good. I wouldn't have known, I mean, I was an art major, but I would not have known that I would end up necessarily an artist at that point, because the truth is, underneath everything, the people where I came from and of my generation, any adult who managed to have a meaningful job of any kind was a lucky person, you know. So that you actually were able to realize some career, especially one that was, there's no examples of, you know, no way, you know, I thought, oh, I'll be a commercial artist, I guess. And somewhere I must have seen some magazine, so I thought I'd have a nice red sports car and a really nice apartment and plenty of girlfriends. And I'd seen the movie, oh, that's a big influence in high school, the movie Moulin Rouge and Jose Ferrer. And I would watch these dancing girls in these nightclubs who were kicking high, and I would drink cognac out of a cane. I didn't even drink in high school, actually, but but that, and I would take my sketch. I don't know how many times I saw the movie, but I would take my sketchbook to the movie and draw, you know, that. And the interesting later coincidence, Jose Ferrer's half-brother, or brother, No, Ferrer. Yeah, he's got a show at the Museo del Barrio. Rafael Ferrer is a friend of mine. But when I met him, I didn't know, Ferrer is a fairly common Latin name, and I didn't know that part. But in the ensuing years, we met in the 60s, late 60s or early 70s in New York. And he was a young artist, you know, I think he's about 4 or 5 years older than me, 3 or 4, I guess. But anyway, we met, you know, and liked each other, but we didn't have much to do with each other. Then one summer in New York, he was at Skowhegan Art School, and I came as a resident teacher, and I came up to do a talk. And so we became really bonded a bit as friends, you know. I haven't seen him in many years, and then I saw in the New York Times about a month ago that he's got this beautiful retrospective at the Museo del Barrio. So I called and sent a message, and so he called me, and we were asking. And so I said, you know, I said, it's funny with you Ferreras. He says, no, I got 2 Ferreras that have influenced me. He says, your brother, you know. and he says, what do you mean? I told him the story, you know, of me and going to the movie. And in other words, his brother's Toulouse-Lautrec, you know. Anyway, all of these convoluted things, when you ask how does somebody become or whatever they are, it's interesting how things come together. And Raphael and I are friends, and I still like Toulouse-Lautrec, and he says, well, his brother would be happy to know that. Of course, he's passed on. So I says, well, he knows.
But the idea of becoming an artist and having that actually...
Yeah, and that was the only movie. The Van Gogh one was later, I think, when I was in the university. But by then I was, you know, on the path, and I knew who Van Gogh was before I saw the movie. You know, that's very different, because at the time I saw Moulin Rouge, I had no idea, you know, that hadn't been a part of my information, you know, and all of that.
What struck you, Sandy, having spent most of your life in Houston, you moved to LA, what struck you about Los Angeles? What was different?
Well, one, it was integrated. It had its differences, as we well know, and still does. But what I mean is, you were free to go. You know, you want to go to the museum, you go. You want to, you know, any number of public things that you want to do, you just can do them. You don't have to think about them and stuff. No, there was a typical police repression and various. You just didn't get caught in Inglewood, various places. My daughter eventually graduated from Inglewood High School, so clearly things have changed, you know, or had changed. But when I came in 1955, LA City College was an integrated university. Significant black population, because a lot of black people went to the junior colleges that were more in the central Los Angeles area than if you were in, you know, places further away. But, and on the football team were people who were Mexican, people who were Jewish, people who were Italian. There's a picture I have of the position, and I happen to have a photograph of the ends, which generally means you were about 6 feet tall or a little taller, and fairly, not overweight, you know, but slender. There's Manuel Gonzalez and Ponte, and you know, and in that 2 year period, the Suez Canal thing blew up in Egypt, and somebody on the team was Egyptian, and of course somebody on the team was Jewish, and we all laughed about, oh, Ginsburg's going to war with, you know, what's his name? And of course they were not, and it wasn't. There was no tension whatsoever. And they said, yeah, they're going to raid the Egyptian theater. You know, one of them, I think it was on Western Avenue. You know, that kind of thing. Well, in Texas, because school and life were segregated, we simply had no interchange with, let's say, Anglo-Americans, you know, unless you worked someplace. But the truth is, our communities were so large, the three black communities, Fifth Ward, Third Ward, and Fourth Ward, that if in your younger years, you had no reason to be in contact with white people. So your parents did, or if you worked somewhere, because they because of employment. However, in the black community, the the larger stores tended to be owned by white people, that is, usually Italian and possibly Jewish. I can't speak to the Jewish part because I worked for an Italian-owned place, Lewis, Orlando. And my grandmother and people in the community knew when the Orlando family came off the boat and started out with small vegetable carts and eventually moved up to owning a store and then to larger stores. And there were about four, and they also lived in the black community because the Anglo-American community didn't welcome them that much in that period, you know. And so they lived usually on the same property as the store that they owned. And the Orlando family did that, and others did. There was the Campese family, the Orlandos, I think Pignatelli's, and the Lucas. Those are the names I can remember. There may have been more. And the ones, they weren't my age, but between my age and my father's age, I think in the Campese family, you know, young men. And of course, they went to white schools because that was, you know, that part they do. And I think they were athletic. They were athletes and rather well known. And one of the Mexican boys in the neighborhood became the best baseball player in Houston High School. Raymond Balderas was his name. But we all played baseball together in the neighborhood. You know, that was, you know, stuff. But he went to that you know, high school, whatever. And we had, it's interesting, in Houston High School athletics, for the black high schools, there was no championship when it came to baseball. Football, basketball, and track, yeah, that was. None of it, of course, was with the white schools, so we had our separate championships and stuff. Well, Texas is a big state, and everybody knows it's crazy about athletics, no matter what the racial groups are or that kind of thing. But the ways people related to each other were different and dynamic, but the law was segregation, you know, and so it had its dynamics and it had its things. So LA was different than that, but you've got to realize many people who live in California migrated from Texas, black or white, or as they said of the Dust Bowl era, but it did. Those immigrations continued. Okie and Arkie, you know, meaning people, white people from Oklahoma and Arkansas. And they also came from Texas and Louisiana, as we did, you know. So at LA City College, our football team, there were white athletes, white football players who were from Texas, just like I was. We couldn't play together there, and we did at LACC. So in a different situation, we, you know, there were relationships between us. So we got to know little things about each other and stuff, you know. But who was close friends with who, that depended on, you know, just personal relationships. I guess just a general fluxing or flexibility that was, California was a northern state. It's west, as we say, we have to go west to go north, you know, but that was it. And in the black South, it's typical that North Carolinians, Alabamans, well, Alabaman people go to Detroit. People from the Carolinas and Virginia go to New York. People from Mississippi go to north to Chicago. And people from Texas and Louisiana go west to California, also Oklahoma. And those patterns still hold. Like the mayor of Los Angeles, Bradley, he was from Texas, you know. And any number of prominent people in California who are Afro-American, either they or their parents came from that route of migration, you know.
If you go down to, you know, that area around Inglewood, Slauson.
Slauson, oh yeah, I know, the Louisiana places, yeah.
Exactly.
I know, still, yeah, still yeah. Well, I lived at Vernon and Van Ness for years, so, you know, and it would have to be still there. Oh, am I scooting your chair back?
Yeah.
How's that? Sorry. Okay.
So after you were at LACC for 2 years?
I went to USC for, SC didn't recruit me for football, but I wanted to go there to play football. The reason I didn't want to necessarily go there any more than anywhere else, I had offers, I guess, from the University of Washington and the University of Denver. And I had heard that the University of Denver had a good art department. And it was a sort of second tier level football, college football school. It eventually gave football up, but I think one of the teachers at LA City College, had come from Denver, and maybe that was where I heard of it or something, I'm not sure. There was a very good art history teacher at LACC, Russell Cangialosi, who had just come back from a year or so in Italy. And he may well still be alive, though. He would be my mother's age, at least, or something like that. There were good teachers at LACC in terms of art, you know, and that sort of thing. Your question. When I transferred to USC, one of my friends, another football player named Don Buford, had gone in January of 57 over to USC. And in the spring, he made their football team. And he came over and told me, he says, you should be going over to SC. He says, we know, I know you can make it there, you know, and stuff. And UCLA was my other option. But UCLA, I didn't like their football system because they had a coach and they had a more primitive football system, an old single wing attack, Red Sanders. Well, since they hadn't come for me, I had to find the money. One of my cousins loaned me some money. He was in the Navy. And I paid my down payment on tuition at USC and went out for the football team and was making fairly good progress and through that year. But I had some problems, me and the coaching or whatever. But anyway, so I was only there a semester. I played two games. I walked on, and I was ninth string. And by the third game, I was the first string or fullback. And two games later, I was back ninth string. Well, that doesn't compute, you know. So there must have been some other reasons other than football ones. It was a bad year for SC. It was probably the worst season in USC's history. They lost 9 games and won 1. But that was coaching. That was pure coaching. That was Don Clark. they had changed coaches just as I arrived. And so I left in January because I hadn't really earned a scholarship, though they were going to find a way for me to stay there. But I was disgusted. And I just left school. And halfway through the semester, I went back over to the art department just to sentimental look around. And Francis Dierdly, the drawing teacher and sort of the prominent member of the faculty who liked me, my work, told me to take my portfolio over to County Art Institute. And he would make a call, and they gave me a scholarship, which started in the summer of 58. And so I did the summer session, and I'd done well, so they gave me the full scholarship bid at County Art Institute. And so I stayed there that fall. I worked part-time at the post office at night in terms of money. Saved money, missed football so much, I bought my way back into USC. And then that spring, went out for the football team again, did well, and this time I got the scholarship and stuff, you know. And so the next year I was there at SC, but I got hurt, freak accident, collarbone, before the first game, so I'd play all season. So I was very, and by having been at an art school for much of a year, I was a different personality than I had been before, because I now had associated fully immersed in art, different than being just in a university. And so it probably was like 9 months of a graduate kind of exposure, even though, you know, it was younger than that. So my head in relation to art was very different by then. I understood more about what it was going to take to be an artist and more what it was to be an artist, you know. And I could see paintings and art much better, way beyond what it was in school. In other words, I could go to a museum and I could see how whatever artists had thought who were mature and serious. And I would, I started buying books. So I bought a book of Goya and his etchings, still have it. Bought a book of Rembrandt's drawings and still have it. You know, a book on Clay and a book on Picasso and stuff. And this is all, you know, the athletics is not in the picture. And also while I was at SC, I didn't really take classes that would get me graduated. So I ended up with an excess of credits, but not the right ones to graduate. Then, so football finished 59. Dearly died in November of 59 while I was away at Notre Dame for my last football game. I did play the last two games of that season. So I played two games in 57, two games in 59, and here's this guy who's crazy about this, you know, that was my life basically, you know. I had much more football than I had girls. It was just true, you know, at that point. And so it's over. But the art thing has gotten full. Then I got married, you know, and I had a daughter that first year. And, you know, you just, it's your grown life, adult life. And I, in the 5 years from 60 to 65, I made art, met people, and a few in this show, in that show kind of thing. In the last semester, and starting, I would say the fall of 59, I had to take sculpture at SC. And I got more interested. And then I saw two graduate students, George Baker and Robert Bassler, and they were welding. And that looked interesting. And so the pictures you see in class with the teacher, Hal Gebhardt, well, Baker was his assistant, and he and Bassler were the grad students. So I took a spring night class with Baker. Because he taught it, he taught me to weld. He laid six strips of steel down, showed me how to weld one, showed me how to weld two, and then helped me weld one, and then I could weld. And he says, okay, you just keep doing this with different pieces of steel, and don't bother me because I'm working on my graduate show. And so that, you know, so there was no aesthetics involved is what I'm getting at. And of course, the way Gebhardt worked, well, he didn't really teach you how he worked anyway. That wasn't his way of teaching, you know. And in retrospect, I'm very happy he was that way. You know, it was more just a person who taught you the principles of sculpture. And of course, in those years, it was primarily through the figure. But other people were involved in other things. When I say other people, graduate students or just work you saw other places. The other advantage of USC is the county museum, the old county museum, right across the street. So you could go in the museum anytime and any major show. And there it was, I think in the spring of 59, a major, or spring of 60, one or the other, a major exhibition of contemporary sculpture, meaning abstract welded sculpture for the most part welded, I think. And so I did see that. And it wasn't like Baker's or, you know, and it was a variety of stuff. Gabriel Cohn, and Gabe wasn't a welder, so there must have been other things.
Did any of them make a bit, was David Smith or?
Nobody was a particular impression because they were, you know, in those years, though Smith, I think in 60, 61 or two, had a major show in LA at Everett Ellen Gallery. I didn't see it, but I heard about it. But it didn't mean much to me. The sculptor who welded, who was in the art school, in the art books at that point, was not Smith, but was Theodore Rozak. Rozak, you know. So you could say that would have been, but, you know, there's little images in the book like that, you know. I mean, you could see they're abstract. But I was further advanced in that, in abstraction, by my own experiments in painting, you know. And I didn't think I was a sculptor then. Don't get me wrong. Sculpture was not important yet. Painting is what was important. And so my paintings that are, you know, I mean, my mother has a couple, and, you know, there are a few around L.A., you know, here and there.
And what did your paintings look like? Were they sort of...
They were abstract.
Kind of expressionist?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, no, no. I wouldn't have been a hard edge. I like geometry, but I would not have limited myself to that kind of tightness at the time. I would have thought it more than I would have done it. My hand wouldn't let me see.
Who were some of the professors at USC when you were studying there?
Francis Dyrdly, Keith Crown, and I think I mentioned at lunch, but Crown was very much a theorist about color, but he was an abstract, figurative abstraction in that you could recognize things, but symbolic and abstract combinations, not literal representations. Symbolist, maybe you'd say.
So mostly watercolors.
Well, he did both, but he got famous for his watercolors. And there's a major book on his work. I was passing through London one year and stopped at the Tate. And after looking at work, I'm in the bookshop, and here's a book, The Watercolors of Keith Crown, beautiful book. And he just passed earlier this year. And he was a fine artist. Edgar Ewing was a fine painter, but I always felt a little more self-contained and, how would I call it, reserved kind of painter. And yet he'd been accused of being a radical communist in the early 50s because he painted a Civil War soldier, Union soldier, with his blue uniform and red gold buttons. And the red was just, you know, how you're trying to make gold look reddish or, you know, that kind of thing. Somebody in L.A. of the McCarthy era decided this was a leaning toward communism. And he evidently, it was before my knowing him, but that was a claim to fame. He's the last person you think of that. But he was a person who liked Ruskin and, you know, the British academic end of the art world, insensibility. He liked Pinwell corduroy suits. I can't remember what Crown wore. I can't remember. Dearly. Conventional, probably a suit and a white shirt, and always the jacket was off and the sleeves were rolled up, you know. And Dyrdly had been a boxer, you know, that in Europe and stuff. So anyway, you know. Hal Gebhardt was a sculpture teacher, and he probably had been very influential in Southern California in sculpture during the war and post-war, but as a teacher more than exhibitions, you know.
Did Hans Burkhardt teach for a semester at USC?
He taught for a semester, and he was, now that you say it that way, Hans was probably the proponent of being adventurously abstract, you know. Because Hans, he took Dyrdly's place. Dyrdly was very ill in that fall of 59, and he passed before the semester was out. And he'd gotten Hans Burkhardt to replace him. Hans was, in his earlier years, a close friend of de Kooning and Gorky. And they were three immigrants who knew each other very well in New York. and who talked and associated with each other. Burkhardt had a job, so he bought paintings from Gorky. And the reason Burkhardt had a job was he came over as an immigrant, but his father had come 20 years before and worked in a furniture reproductions place where you made furniture look like it was antique and Chippendales and whatever, you know. And so he taught Burkhardt that and got him a job in that. So even though it was a depression, Burkhardt had a job, you know, and there still was a demand for that kind of a luxury product. At least that's as the story as Hans told it, as I remember. But Hans seemed to like my work in school, but more than that, I liked what he was exposing us to, which had to do with Gorky's approach to abstraction. He didn't mention de Kooning's work as much as he did de Kooning, and the way he put it was, Gorky was the advanced one when they knew each other. And he and de Kooning were more like learning significantly through their relationship with Gorky, you know.
What did you think of Burkhardt's own work in the
late? I liked it. Because I liked his independence. You see, Hans wasn't like anybody. He wasn't like the newer hot shots, if you will. And he wasn't like the older shots. He stayed that way. Hans was like a self-taught made man. You were not going to. When he first came to our class, he met with us the first time and he looked at the, you know. We came in the next time to, you know, draw, because of a drawing class he took. He had come early and with his own bucket of gray paint, painted all the walls so they were clean, you know. Because he was a painter. He had earned his living for years in the scene painting part of Hollywood. He was a part of the union and that kind of thing. He referred to the scabs like Ronald Reagan. He referred to them back then before Reagan was anything or politically or that kind of thing, because he didn't appreciate people, you know. And Hans also liked the human emotion of expressionists, I guess to say the expressionist side of digging into. He'd go to Mexico and dig up skulls or find them in the cemetery and bring them. There's a painting or two. What's the gallery here that showed? Yeah, you know, I was here 1 year a few years ago and he was showing a lot of Hans's. I stayed there for a couple hours because I knew Hans, you know. And he just was a positive person as far as, but independent. And what I mean by that is, though he's living in an art world environment, as we all do, his relation to it was, Hans was gonna do it his way, you know. And I liked that. I thought that was what you were supposed to do, bring art out of yourself, not how well you could do something like somebody else thinks up the concepts or ideas for, you know. And I think that still stands in his work, you know. You didn't work like him, because that would be the antithesis of that idea. But at the same time, the concept of abstraction made me think, well, what does the word really mean? Yeah, everybody is, anything you don't recognize as abstraction, you know, or anything painted without apparent relationship to another set of objects or forms, you know. But the term itself, abstraction, like extraction, you know, all those rootly related words mean you develop something from something else. You can develop conceptually from something, or you can develop it from the visibility of objects or things, you know. And I always took words and things apart, not all the time, but I mean, occasionally things that seemed important or something like that to me, I would take them apart, and it usually helped me understand what I wanted to try and how I wanted to try and think about those things. And I think that was helpful. But I never had that conversation with him, or with mostly with myself, you know. So even my friends wouldn't know that was how I was thinking about what I was doing, you know. They naturally react to what I produced or not, you know. So when I got to welded sculpture, I was already an abstract thinker, you know, in terms of making things. But since I was working with material which was new to me, steel, and you know, compared to, well, it just handled differently. You could make things stick together, and it was a little hard. It was not an easy material, so to speak. You know, it wasn't fluid like paint or something. And I think I liked that. And this is my own intuition about myself. I like things that resist my trying to make them, because in that we kind of get something. I always get something I don't expect. You know, find something in the work, you know. So it's not so much a preconception of something as is something happens in the doing that develops the conception, you know, so to speak, you know.
When we look at, you showed us some figurative sculpture, which I imagine you made.
You mean in the book?
Yeah.
Oh, well, that was a class assignment.
But you made that by model.
Oh, yeah, I mean.
And then when you learn to weld, you have to learn a whole new way of approaching sculpture, right? You can't mold.
Well, yeah, but you don't try to mold.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, it's just like football and basketball. You don't go kicking the basketball around. You know, it's just natural that you don't do it. You know, you got to figure out some other things. And it's not much of a, I mean, though, even though you see a work by people who did try and do those things, who did do those things, in fact, you know, sculptors who model with the welding torch, you know, who made the make figures and try and make them anatomically, you know, and or just expressionistically. And I mean, I've knocked out a few, how you say, forms and things and stuff, but that wasn't my focus, you know. Because you find out, well, I can do anything with steel. Steel's probably, next to paper, the most commonly used material in our society. You know, paper and cloth, you know. And it comes out of the industrial world in sheets like paper does, in stacks, or in wires, or in, you know. So you can get this material in any kind of form. And once you start to understand it as a material, you can do anything you want to do with it, you know. But knowing what you want to do in advance or in process or in retrospect are all possibilities, you know. And I tend to work by finding my way. I don't draw for the Lynch fragments, there are no drawings for them. There are drawings that resemble the Lynch fragments in doing curiosity drawings, but they're never for a work. And often I draw after I've made something. I say, oh, you know, I could have done this way, or just it's quick to get this set of ideas out, you know, that kind of thing. And I often think, you just don't have only so much time in life, that there are ideas within the fragments, because I use that as an arena of experimentation for so long, that there are ideas for all kinds of things, from architecture to very large scale paintings to all kinds of things. I know they're there. I've occasionally made notations and, you know, little notebook drawings, because my notebooks are full of everything. They're not, you know, 500 versions of the Lynch Fragments or something like that. They're everything from my opinion of this or that, therefore nobody will see these notebooks till after I'm gone. But, they literally are your variations of your thinking and stuff like that. And the
will you, from the very beginning, tell us about the Lynch Fragments and, you know, what year they started, but also more broadly, the conceptual breadth of them? Because that's something
I understand.
Sure. In our museum,
and how they came to be called Lynch
Fragments. You have the Brinson, retrospective catalog?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, you haven't read it.
Essay.
You read it?
Yes, I have.
Okay, all right, okay.
The whole essay.
On him. His is not bad. His is one of the best. The other person who spent time with me in the work that and who's written, what's her name? April Kingsley, you know, and a couple of other people, but those are keys since the New York years, you know. Okay, the Lynch Fragments themselves. Let's say in about 1960, from 60, when I left SC, but I hadn't graduated. So occasionally I would take a night class to take care of that. And I took, Spanish, bacteriology, because they let me in without a foreign language. They wouldn't let me out without it. And I never took a science requirement. And I think there was one art history class I hadn't taken. So I took the Spanish and art history at UCLA in 64, 65. But I took bacteriology at USC I think it was about 62 or 63, one night class, because I was working, you know, in the daytime, that kind of thing. 62, I took a night class at SC from George Baker, who by then had a permanent part-time night class at SC, because I didn't have any welding equipment and I wanted to really to weld. I had knocked together a few abstract wooden things, but, you know, that wasn't steel, that wasn't the thing. I took a class with George, and he just, you got the equipment, do what you want to do. George was a friend, not a teacher, you know. And unless there was some piece of equipment I didn't know how to use or something. And George was really busy developing his career. Is he someone you people know? George Baker. He's a sculptor who teaches at Occidental College. Okay. I haven't seen his work or anything in years, and I'm curious. But anyway, George taught me how to weld. I took the class. Before it was over, I bought my own welding equipment. So from then on, I was welding. That was 62. And then I started just making experiments, you know, in steel, in the garage behind my place on Van Ness. And a lot of the experiments were in relief form, because you simply lay down stuff and just join them, you know, but in interesting, and since I'd been a painter, composing, you know, left, right, horizontal, and relatively flatly was a normal way of thinking about things. But I sat down one day and wrote out what was the difference for me in sculpture and painting, because painting is flat and on a wall, no matter how much dimension you're interested in. And so I diagrammed that I should, if I was going to be a sculptor, make something which came up from the floor like sculpture does, you know, something that came from the walls and something that came from the ceiling. In other words, it should be all three dimensions, you know. And I wish I could find that piece of paper to this day. I wrote, you know. And that kind of opened the door to myself for me, that sculpture would be really three-dimensional. And also my own socio-political thinking in the period. This is the late 50s, early 60s, you know. The political world in relation to African Americans was really making you thoughtful, especially if you were a young person who had the life's experience I already had, which was to go back over it 7 years in Texas as a child. No white people in the world because you're a child. You know, you just, okay. We go to Ohio. Oh, you're in an integrated school. You know, okay. Oh, there are conflicts because, racial conflicts because you're immigrants from the South and there are white people who are immigrants from the South. And, you know, they have parents and older people. They have thinking which comes from both from the South. The first school I went to, Waugaman Elementary School, after the first year, most of the white students from that school were bused to another school because they were families who were primarily migrating from Kentucky and Tennessee. As they referred to each other as Ridge Runners and something else, I forget, but that was their Tennessee to Kentucky kind of rivalry. Some were friends and some were not, you know. But evidently there had been enough problems at the school, I wasn't aware of them, that they thought that community would be better served if they were bused to another school, which essentially made Waugaman all black. My father said, well, we just came from the South. We didn't come here to have you have to be in the same way things were in Texas. So he worked out a way that I got transferred to the same school, Irving Elementary on Cincinnati and Albany Streets in Dayton. Well, it was just a more balanced area of Dayton in terms of the community, and there weren't any particular problems. We had all the differences we had, you know, but they didn't seem to mean anything. An occasional little thing, but nothing major in my experience, let's put it that way. But clearly in the adult world, they were aware of more problems than I would have been, and that was why that was. One of my teachers, my third grade teacher from Waugaman, had been transferred there, so she was the one teacher that I knew at Irving that had come from from Waugaman, and that was Mrs. Lemon, a lady named Mrs. Lemon. I would guess she was 40 to 50 because she was a brunette with a few gray streaks in her hair. And I remember as a, you know, oh, Melvin, you're here too, you know, that guy. She was a very nice lady.
What you were saying is that late 50s, early 60s is sort of the height of the civil rights.
I forgot, that's where I was, wasn't it? No, remind me whenever I go off, because I do. What I meant, and the reason for the Dayton thing, was I had experienced life in the North. Then we moved back to Texas, I'm 12, and it's the South. Now, the South is for real in terms of segregation and law and stuff like that. So my mother has to sit me down and tell me, look, this is the way things are. You get on a bus, and the signs are on the buses, and they say, you know, colored, white, and you ride the back of the bus, and this and that. So, you know, drinking fountains say black and white, or not black, but colored and white. And you obey those things, you know, because otherwise there can be real problems. You know, that was the law. It was American apartheid, and that was simple as that. Now, like I explained earlier, the community, Fifth Ward, was so 50,000 people or more. It's all black, three movie theaters, and the Finnegan Park and Kelly Courts, those are the places I went to play and stuff. Nightclubs for adults and stuff. Nobody needed downtown. Nobody needed white people except for jobs and the kind of adult relationships that adults had. Or, you know, so, you know, that was what people may not understand, but that was what segregation was designed to do, you know. So people had their, not absolutely separate, but basically separate worlds. So that was the way that was. But we knew things were wrong. You know, now in 54, I was in 11th grade. In the spring, the 54 school segregation Supreme Court ruling came. So the schools were going to be different. I thought that meant, oh, in September, you know where my mind was? Oh, we're going to play the white boys. We're going to play football against them. That was, I didn't care about the school or education and stuff. I was a football player. Well, of course, they didn't do it right away. In fact, it didn't happen in the fall of 54. It happened in the fall of 65, 10 years later. So even my two younger brothers who were 10 years younger than me never experienced integrated school in Houston. And when they integrated, a lot of the really integrated, a lot of the reason was because of the love that all Texas people have for sports. Because they had integrated, and then they had started to have not two separate championships and everything, but one. And the black schools started to dominate. Now, my high school was an extremely competitive school in sports. When I was in high school my last year, we won state championship in football, in basketball, in track. Nobody does that in a state like Texas. I don't know if it's ever been done again in the history. And for instance, on our track team, one of my football teammates who ran track was a hurdler. He had the fastest time, not in Texas, but in the nation. You know, Ralph Jones, and he's still a good buddy. And stuff. But that was typical. You know, it was really a national caliber athletic thing. And the higher levels, that is the major cities in Texas, the sports teams and the coaches were very, very good. I never had better ones at SC. Never. And most of them couldn't have coached at my high school, you know. That was just the level of the people. I had five, the coaches were, of the five coaches, three had been All-American quarterbacks. That means they were the ones given the credit for the most thinking. I don't think they had the most. I mean, they were, what I mean is the line coaches and the other people were as much football intellectually conceptual and all of that. We used systems that I didn't see in college, but I saw in professional football, in high school. And So when the reason they then integrated was when they started having the state competitions in high school in Texas, my high school, which had won state championship in basketball every year, I was in junior high and high school, 6 years in a row. They then won the first three state championships that were integrated. So the white coaches started patrolling the black neighborhoods early in the morning to look for athletes. And they convinced people that, hey, if we don't, we're just going to look, you know. And everything integrated that way. The other quasi-political part of it was to avoid real integration, they first tended to put blacks and Mexicans together before they later, so schools, there was a lot of gerrymandering around that kind of thing. LA had all of these people who come from the South, the Southwest, you know, and, you know, it had its racial dynamics, its discriminations in jobs and this and that. And when the riot happened in 65, the riot that some people call a riot and some call a rebellion, and it was those things, you know. Well, various incidents had happened. They had killed a man named Ronald Stokes, who was a Muslim. They used the newspapers and police department used the Muslims as a scapegoat. You know, what these people were basically, to simplify, is they were people who didn't want to be Baptists and didn't want to be Presbyterians and stuff like that anymore. African Americans, and they wanted something that they felt was closer to black culture. And that particular group, the Nation of Islam, offered that, you know. But otherwise, they were just neighbors. They sold newspapers, and you had a lot of political arguments or stuff, but they were no problem in the community. But the kind of Southern California that LA was in relation to the police department and other official kind of relations meant that sooner or later there was going to be a major conflict, and it exploded, you know. And it was, it seemed normal that it would happen. And I would say in any other country in the world, those kinds of explosions, we see they happen all the time, all over the world, when communities feel oppressed by another community and stuff. They're just not new human interactions. But in the United States, it was based on the history of slavery and its consequences for 100 years, you know. So, you know, but it changed things. So people started getting elected. People started, I got a teaching job in a university. They came and got me because I, you know. So I got a job at Chouinard, you know.
Did you think of the Lynch Fragments as political work?
Politics was a part of it, always. But culturally expressive works, yes. Culturally or socially expressive, yes. But not an ism, you know. And when I say, the reason for the collective, see, at first, I had no collective name for them. At first, they were these little experimental things. And then with various people, we talked about, you know, black art, black artists, primarily among other black people who were in the arts, both literature, everything. That those conversations were going on. I liked Richard Wright's writing, you know. I appreciated Paul Robeson. You know, this is in the 50s and when I'm in college. I had read Richard Wright, I was at least in high school and maybe earlier because my mother subscribed for a couple of years to the Book of the Month Club and things. I came from a family, primarily my mother, who read a lot, you know, and stuff. So I had that. So I would look for things. I had read in about 56 or 7, Chester Himes. It was the only book of his that he wrote based on Los Angeles. It's not The Quality of Hurt. It's in If He Hollers, Let Him Go, you know. But those are African-American writers who focus on the experience of African-Americans. And later on, what's his name? Ralph Ellison, who wrote Invisible Man. Somewhere there's a piece of mine called Going Invisible in Los Angeles. And it comes from that. His conceptual art piece in that book, if you know that book, Invisible Man, there's a basement. And a man in his basement, for no reason whatsoever, has like a wall full of light bulbs, which all come on, you know, and stuff. That would have been a perfect 1960s next to a Flavin or a this or a that, you know. But Ellison wrote that 20 years before, you know. So these conceptual ideas that when somebody says political as if it's some kind of separate, possibly not as advanced aesthetically set of ideas. They don't understand aesthetics historically or hysterically. You know, and I took on the term art for art's sake because that was the dominant rhetorical aesthetic banner flown beside abstract expressionism. And I said, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense. I mean, what the artists are doing makes sense. But what doesn't make sense? Art doesn't make art, people make art. And history says, that people have made art for every possible reason under the sun. And there's examples of all of those reasons in all of the world's art. And I happen to know that when I study art history, contemporary art history, there's no China, 25% of the world in population. How come China is not there? How come India is not there? You know. So something's not being done right and being said that it is this. I said, but okay, I know about that stuff because baseball has a World Series and they don't play baseball most of the world. You know, so societies do things like that culturally, you know. And I'm being a young adult who's trying to think, you know, trying to be creative in a sound or fundamental way or way that makes sense to me, you know. Is you know, an older person in the family would say, well, shit, use your head. Use your own sense. Use your own thinking. You can think, you know. They can think, you can think.
How did the name Lynch Fragments come to be associated?
I was saying, what's dynamic? What's an experience that's ours? And when I said art for art's sake couldn't fly, it was in the middle of that kind of thinking. And I said, well, the only thing, or not the only, but an important thing that happens to us is lynching. You know, although there are, you know, white people have been lynched and all kinds of people had been, but symbolically in the United States, that's us. Well, we can't take that shit, or why can't we do something just as strong? Or in visual arts, why can't I make something as strong as that to combat something like that? And what does it consist of? Well, the stereotypical notion of lynching, movie-wise and in actuality, is hanging, suspension. And I've just started to play with those three-dimensional ideas that I talked about. Well, from the ceiling it hangs and stuff, kind of thing. So. One of, you know, the suspended piece in the L.A. show that in the book, it's called Chaino. Well, it's really for two reasons. And this is where, when you ask me, is it politics? And I say, well, it's politics, but it's culture. And culture is larger than, politics is inside of culture, you know, in terms of the general construct. That piece is called Chaino. Not just because there's chain there, but because in that period, in listening to black music, which was the other reference for me in terms of aesthetics, and what do you do about being expressive as an African American that's from your culture. And a big African influence in Afro-American music, which was new starting in the 1940s, was Afro-Cuban music. And it was in particular brought to importance by a drummer from Cuba, from Havana, named Chano Pozo. Chano Pozo was killed in 1948 in a bar fight or something like that. But he was with Dizzy Gillespie and Machito, and came first through Machito. He'd come from Cuba, and he was an incredible drummer, not just an incredible drummer, but an actual African ritual, in Cuban ritual, religious Afro-Cuban processes, an Agbakwa drummer in those religious processes. And he brought that kind of percussion dynamics into jazz, into the highest level of experimental black music at the time, which was bebop, which was at the Dizzy Gillespie Orchestra, and any number of significant compositions, and a whole influence into the Afro-American ways of using rhythm, which were already there, but differently than the more directly African traditional that they were using. Afro-Americans mixed it all up so much, religious, secular, etc., that it was creatively, significantly something else. Plus, it of course had taken place in North America, you know. But the Cubans, no, they still had the African religious processes going on. So you could be a popular musician with popular songs, but the rhythmic thing was often influenced or dominated by these African religious things. And the way people improvised and danced and improvised and sang and improvised and played and composed music, it was just a mesh. Okay, Chano was killed. And this is 10 years later, 15 years later that I'm searching for words. And so I was working in a place called Record Rack. They sold records, put a little rack of records in various drugstores and places like that, and they sold for 99 cents. I worked for them in their warehouse. And I would fill orders to go to different drugstores. And out pops a record by Chino Pozo, not Chano, Chino. Chino Pozo turns out to be, according to the recording, and I've never seen that record since that moment. I should never have shipped it out. I should have stole it and kept it. But Chino Pozo was the brother of Chano Pozo. And he was sort of trying to continue what his brother was putting into jazz by, and it listed all these different ritual songs. Which years later, after my African experience, I understood easily. Shango, Yemaya, et cetera, all these names. Anyway, the short of it is, leaving work and going home with now having Chano's name in my head, and now I got Chino. Entitling this piece, I named it Chino, Chaino. So, but you know, since my work is about chains, everybody said, Chino, okay. You know, because, and that one is suspended. Okay, that still doesn't answer the Lynch fragments totally. Anyway, at a certain point right in there, I was reading Freedom Ways magazine, which was a quarterly, Afro-American quarterly, which was very political. And it talked about the history of lynchings. And it indicated places you could find the history of lynching and that sort of thing. A major essay, I can't remember what issue, but it mentioned the Tuskegee archives of lynching, and there were 5,000 lynchings in that archive here and there, and that there was a book by Ginsburg, a man named Ginsburg, not Ginsburg the poet, but. And anyway, and it called 100 Years of Lynchings. And it was published just about that time. So I got it, you know. And so I said, okay. So I've been making the works. I was sort of, you know, fragmented kind of ideas. In other words, if you take the word abstraction and say abstraction, lynched abstraction doesn't play. But Lynch Fragments does. And it's fragments of different ideas, both visually and conceptually, anyway. And so I thought that was a name to package. By the time I developed the name for the group, I probably had made a dozen pieces already with not a collective name for them, but individual titles. And those titles ran the gamut of any number of cultural references. You know, Some Bright Morning was, the first one was specifically about a black family in Florida who resisted people who were trying to intimidate them. Said, some morning if you people don't stop acting the way you are, we're gonna come after you. And some morning they came, but the people were prepared and they, guerrilla warfare style, fought them off and backed off into the woods or whatever of Florida. And later on, it turned out that that was a documented incident under the name of Rosewood, a small black community called Rosewood. It seems that that's the one they were talking about. I wasn't that sure about that part, but I knew that this family had resisted. And that was what I wanted most out of it, was that the work wouldn't be considered just formal abstractions, because then it would just be stuck in a formalist kind of criticisms, or these are nice abstract things, or this or that, and they're dynamic, really good, but, you know. So I wanted them loaded up. I wanted the title to make people think, because I didn't see why there couldn't be some language and expression in the modern art world that was honestly about what I came from, you know. Okay, Sunday, that's almost Rembrandt. You know, there's a Rembrandt etching. Remember I told you I bought a book of Rembrandt etchings of the prodigal son returning home? That's why it's spelled S-O-N-D-A-Y. So, you know, I'm the oldest son in my family. You know, I'm not that I was run away and out of touch or that, but just that there's some responsibilities on you as a man, as a person, to be productive. Sorry, I hope I didn't mess with your sound. I'm sorry, I forgot. I didn't beat my chest.
Inside and Out?
Inside and Out had to do with thoughts inside and out, but it as much referenced the three-dimensional qualities of that piece. And that piece, if you notice, the fragments are of different levels of projection in them. And usually it's relatively meaningful in the particular object, you know. And so that form was contained inside. You know how in the Renaissance concept of space is the box? You could transpose that. You literally could transpose that. Because I was very interested in the Renaissance idea of chiaroscuro, projecting form and stuff. Probably that was a part of what I liked about Dearly, as not that he was that much, but he was interested in that kind of a dynamic. And his work often was socially expressive, at least of workers and stuff. And he was a person who had truly experienced World War II, being a refugee. He came over in the same boat as Bartok, and he's Hungarian and that, you know. Afro Phoenix was exactly what it, for anybody who knows the legend of the Phoenix, you know, which is Egyptian in origins, you know, they tend to talk about it through Greece, but it's older in Egypt. But in any case, what's the process, reincarnation or redevelopment or renaissance-ish? But in other words, the idea that an idea or a people or a civilization or a culture, in our case, the African-American community, had a history which it was reconsidering itself, reinventing itself. And that was about that. You know, that was why the title. And the Lynch Fragments, it was a way, all of that is in a funny way, a way of declaring, you can have all of this stuff in modern experimental art. And the Lynch Fragments were always modern experimental sculpture. Experimental meaning what it's composed of and how I compose it. You know, which in my head was no less experimental than Pollock, no less experimental than Picasso, no less experimental than anybody else, because we're talking about the concept, not the imitation of the styles, but the concept of experiment, you know, experiment in visual arts. And if I didn't say this before, I know I've said it various times, my take on abstraction also came from, since I, you know, went to school like most of my generation, the Picasso and the development of cubism and using at least some ideas from the concepts they found in African art as a part of the concept for change. I thought, you know, there should be more to it than that. And that Picasso, if he was responsible for so-called total abstraction, and then when he started to emphasize the figure again, people said, oh, well, he's returning to the figure. He's not as abstract as he was when it, and I had a question about that, and I'll put it aside for a moment. Then Pollock, when he's doing finally his all-over gestural, from the bucket, pure material on the canvas kind of things, then he's the purest of the purest in terms of abstraction. Then when he starts to sling the paint and images start to appear, oh, he's going backwards. Okay, I said, no. People are not seeing this the right way. Both of these artists have taken all the means at their disposal to make art and saying all of it is material. Figuration is material, material that is absolutely new, the flow of the material, the paint, how you put it down, the tools, all of that is a part of the being, the making of the art. Follow? That whole process is an abstraction process, meaning you move from one set of ideas and you through material and ideas and imagery or whatever, and you make something else. That whole transposition is the actual abstraction. That's what I believe abstraction is. Therefore, you can use figure or not. You can mix anything. And of course, since then, people have actually been doing that, but nobody seems to want to take on that conceptual statement, though they take it on in how they work. And at this point, of course, we use cameras and, you know, it's like collage, montage, etc. It's all of it. An artist can take every process we know, go into a room or onto some geographical place and spoil it with his, you know, use of all this stuff, and that would be his thing. What would you call it if it isn't abstract? It has to be an abstraction because it ain't what it was, none of it, you know. So that was, I'm sorry to go so roundabout, but it's the only way I can, and so what am I doing with these little things that I decide won't be any bigger than this, basically? Because I decided not to make them any larger. You know, I did other things that are larger that have some of those concepts and ideas in them, but the Lynch fragments, I've kept them small. And it's another lesson from music from an earlier time. Most of the music you heard in the 40s, 50s was 3 minutes long. And everybody who knows a little bit about music knows, well, the records, they have no more space on the record than 3 minutes, so for the most part. So, well, you got a Charlie Parker, very complicated thing for 3 minutes. Now, if you really had Charlie Parker in a place and playing, he'd take that same material and expand it to 20 minutes if he wanted to, because he was able to develop theme of, you know, development of the aesthetic principles to that extent. But, and so that only happened in live situations. But for records, it was all 3 minutes. Well, you get a Beethoven quartet. You get a Schoenberg or Webern thing. They're 3 minutes, right? But no, that's high art and this jazz stuff is not. Why, how could that be? A human being is being created for 3 minutes in this particular form, in that particular form, and all over the world people are, but they're not recorded. And then you go places and people play all night long, one composition, right? It's coming all over the world, you know. So You see what I'm getting at? So I was understanding these things. That's basically what I'm trying to say. So yeah, this little thing is a fragment of a much bigger idea. You know.
Can I ask you one question and mm-hmm. take a break for a few minutes? Mm-hmm. Will you explain to us very explicitly the way you like the Lynch fragments exhibited?
Okay. Basically, it's a modular system. You know how, it's an anatomical thing. Can I stand up?
Sure.
Okay. I'm a creaky old example. Okay. You know the old Leonardo da Vinci figure? Things like this? Okay. When I was young, making the Lynch fragments, I was exactly 6 feet tall, and my fingertip to fingertip was 72 inches, which is 6 feet, right? I was perfect. Okay, but anyway, I was aware of modern architects, people interested in thinking, well, a door should be the natural height relative to a human being. I just interpreted, I said, well, a natural height for art in relation to me is my size, you know. And so the Lynch fragments would be 69 inches to my eye level, because everybody functions at their own personal eye level. But this is my work, so it's a presentation from me, from my vision place, and that's 69 inches from the floor, okay? And a natural... No, to my eye. I
work to the hole.
To the hole in the back. Yeah, to the hole in the back. Which some people say, but that'll make the line go like this. I said, don't worry, it works out. You know, and it does. But anyway, so to here. So anyway, and of course, this is three pieces, right? Here, here, and here. You know? Or in other words, you, just to be mechanical, thing for hanging right in the back, 69 inches from the floor, and you divide 72, and that's the 36 point, you know, and that's a perfect way. It's always a little, people won't, I've got one friend who's just hung some, and I says, I'm going to break up a dear old friendship if I say anything. Just, I won't tell anybody where the show is. I'm coming with, I'm bringing a hammer.
Is this a
good,
can we take a little break for a few minutes?
Sorry, yeah.
Is that okay?
Rolling? Is that, you focused a little bit on the other side, like there's Lynch fragments.
Mm-hmm.
And the word Lynch is so... charge that people tend to ignore the other...
The real title of the individual pieces. I agree.
And because it seemed to me that at the same time you're doing these fragments, which you gave a really good description of, a little piece of a bigger conceptual whole, you're also making work which is much more wholes, dealing with the space as a totality.
Mm-hmm.
As you said, the ceiling, the floor, and the wall, the connection between them.
And there have been, through the years, various works that got to be specific. The Lynch fragments, of course, you know, anybody knows my work knows they go to the wall. But any number of shows. It was a show at the Studio Museum in Harlem in 1969. Myself, William Williams, and Sam Gilliam. What came from the earlier things in that show would be chain as a material, suspension as a form and a way of making a piece, but very differently. In the show photographs I gave you, that's the Whitney show, which was actually March of 1970, but versions of the work that were in that show were shown on the previous June at the Studio Museum in Harlem. and they were a barbed wire piece called Pyramid Up, Pyramid Down, and the barbed wire curtain, which are in, again, in kind of the playing with the language and the concepts in modern art. You know, the term drawing in space in reference to sculpture tended to come about around the time of Julio Gonzalez, and they referred to that. Well, using chain and barbed wire as linear materials in doing those works was explicitly a kind of drawing in space that I was aware of. It wasn't, I mean, no, I was aware of art history, you know, not, I wasn't just doing stuff and somebody else would point out, oh, that's drawing in space. Well, shit, I know drawing and, excuse the expression, but line, volume, and plane and form are basic parts of art no matter what you do. I happen to tend to work with some concept of the basics involved in my work no matter what is going on topically. You know, that's just the way I think about work, you know, or ways of working. It gives me, for instance, those same chain and barbed wire pieces gave me a set of drawings, not drawings of, but taking that kind of barbed wire line hanging, two or three or four or five or six, and the chain loops that connect it, because the barbed wire is flexible only as you manipulate it. The chain is flexible based on gravity and the suspension space in between, excuse me, between two points. You know, anyway, I would lay a piece of paper on a board, then make a version of one of those chain barbed wire pieces, lay it on it, spray it with acrylic or enamels or various things, and then pull them off. So the piece has now been transferred, formed from being a piece of sculpture to being a tool for creating these drawings, okay? The Museum of Modern Art owns a couple of them from about 1969, okay? In other words, being aware of that, no, you could say it's, well, space, negative space, of which there is no such thing, because all space is, and we'd use the term just to describe the space between form, the space that exists between two physical forms that we understand, you know. But all space is, there's no such thing as negative space. Art 101, they don't teach it that way, but that's, you know, as a sculptor, that's a kind of awareness I understood that I had to have, or that I developed while working, you know. Anyway, somewhere I lost your question.
We're talking about the more, but it is a good segue to get into those, the suspension pieces, okay, and the things in the mid-60s you were doing at the same time as Lynch Fragments.
Exactly. When I mentioned earlier chain-o and chain-up, and I said, well, the way to get something in the space not coming from the floor was to suspend it. And you could suspend from the ceiling, the wall, the floor. So chain-o ultimately became like that. Then when I was, my work was going to be in the show at the County Museum, I decided I wanted that piece. But the County Museum was brand new. They were not about to let me hook it into a ceiling or a wall with something like that. Just hadn't come up yet. Later, I'm sure they would have done it. But Maurice Tuckman was a new curator then. Anyway, so I said, well, I'll build a suspension unit. And so that's why I built the frame. But in doing it, I wanted something that implied or visually implied more, not just a this side, that side reading, but around the kind of space to view it. And yet, it's not that big an object, you know, so there's, so what I did was build, essentially was a cube, except it was the triangle, you know, base. But they're reversed. In other words, the angle goes up this way on this end, and up that way on that end. And so the space in between, it kind of does a funny thing to your eye. No, I won't say I studied perception. You know, I observed what I was finding out by having to look. But there are two or three places that could come from in my experience. One had to do with sports again. The way in sports, in basketball or football, you diagram plays is from above. So you consider the three-dimensional space, you do it up on a flat board, but the concept is you're diagramming three-dimensional space, horizontal and, you know, and vertical, et cetera, and then the movement of forms in those spaces. Also, dancers and choreographers do the same thing, you know. So if I'm making a complicated piece in more than one part, then I'm playing with space that way. It happens often when people are simply placing sculpture in groups in a space. But unless you're a sculptor who's working with two or three part pieces that are separate from each other, you don't necessarily conceive that. Well, the other thing was I wanted the fragments, I mentioned the distance. I really wanted to do a room for each group, a room that was circular, a room that was an equal-sided square room, and a room that was a triangle, you know, equal-sided. The barbed wire piece called Pyramid Up, Pyramid Down meant that the apex of one side was at the top where you expect the apex to be. But the way it's made, the piece is made, you have a space, you build a wall. So you have a corner on this side, and on the other side of the wall, you have a corner, right? Okay. On this side, the base is here, and you go up, and the apex is there. And it's simply made by barbed wire going from one side of the wall to the other. So you've got this quarter section of a quadrilateral pyramid, right? Okay. Then on the other side of the wall, the walls in between, the other side of the wall, you've got the apex down. So again, it's just diagrammed by strands of barbed wire going across. But when you stand over here, where the wall is there and the two parts are, you get this sort of flipping or warping of the kind of space. It's similar to what I did with the frame for Chano in terms of visual dynamics. Well, nobody talks about me doing that stuff. You know what I mean? That's the structural and possibly dynamics of the aesthetics of the piece. Of course, pyramid up and pyramid down, or pyramid down and pyramid up, could poetically be equated with Afro Phoenix, you know, but you have to think like I think. Okay, well, you know, in other words, if you don't do your ideas, nobody else is going to do them. That's really what I think my work has been about. I don't know how to say it more than that. I don't know whether my, you know, and I'm sure some of my ideas are very mundane, but there are some examples, I think, that are unusual enough that what I was thinking about, or what was curiosity to me, when I got to work with the ideas, it did produce something that was something somebody might want to look at, you know, find some interest in. So all of the work has, from my point of view, conceptual stuff in it like that. And I just think it's the kind of curiosity that all people have in them when they're free to work with what they might imagine that they might invent or might try to do and see what happens. I was always the kind of kid who I could entertain myself because I would always find something to do, something to make, something to, you know, not just play with, but to actually try to construct. And if if I had a whole lot of money at this point, I know I would make architecture. I know I would build a small city or something. I always liked the idea of Brasilia. I always liked the idea that Nigeria finally built, you know, Abuja, a new capital. I don't know what it looks like, but Brasilia, I knew about from the, you know, the 50s, and always thought that was what all countries, all cities, all places should do. And we're seeing the result of the fact that we don't plan and develop cities and direct human beings, because you know, we're just messing up by not, you know, organizing creatively the world we live in, you know. And while the work may be have the aspect of being political from the point of view of pointing out various problems in human relations, the other part, and I think that that shows to some extent in my larger public work, that no, you point out problems, but you also create things that are actually, if not solutions, at least a part of making the world better and different. And so the public works, and that's what I like to call them, I like to say the fragments and the smaller works are more about a personal expression of person-to-person communication, if you like. And the public works are as public communications are to human beings, that they should be things that allow us to function better in the world as human beings. So I take seriously the term public art. When it's not just, oh yeah, you got a chance to make something big, you know, well, you know, you can just get fat and be big, you know, and I've done that, which to my detriment, and I'm now diabetic and you know, other problems, but I'm just saying, as a human being, if we could come closer to what we're capable of in creative terms, we make the world better for everybody, you know. You know, and my experience in, again, in sports and life is it's very, even if I have to say in pure capitalistic terms, football is now an income for a whole lot more people than it was when it was segregated. So is baseball, so is basketball. A whole lot of people in the world make a living. Now, I'm not going to say that's the those are the best examples of human creativity, but at least at base, they're not about killing each other, you know. I mean, people do get worked and possibly exploited when they're not paid enough to do, to you know, to function in those occupations, but that can be improved, you know. And so, you follow, I'm not, I guess I am trying to be a bit utopian or a bit ambitious for human beings, but why shouldn't we be? And why shouldn't what it takes to think creatively and call something Lynch Fragments not make people think that, well, lynching's not good, so, you know, let's do something else. Fine, I won't make any more if we'll do something else. But so far, human beings are still exploiting each other, you know. There's going to be a piece in the show this year. It's a Lynch Fragment made in 2003. It's called Iraq. And I don't care what anybody says, that's not a right thing to do. There's a, another piece from the 70s in a show, and it's called Nam. And it's, again, that wasn't a good thing to do, you know. You know, and these are all things that have happened in my adult life. So
you talked a little bit about the Watts Rebellion. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to ask you, sort of two-part, I mean, there's both the very literal, because from what I know, you were working on August, the fire.
Square, the squared fire, sure.
Right at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So you talk literally about that, but also then how the rebellion, in broader terms, affected you.
The rebellion, I went around and took a lot of photographs. There's one in the catalog just of the two soldiers sitting there, but you know, National Guardsmen, but there were others. You know, that I took. There was a show in Milwaukee related to Watts and what happened after Watts. And they used half a dozen of my photographs. I didn't go out shooting while guns were going off and stuff, but sort of aftermath and, you know, the cash register laying in the burned building, the mannequins falling out of the window and stuff, you know. But visual images that said something terrible has happened here, you know. And the truth is, from my point of view, the terrible thing wasn't that it happened, but that the situation existed that it had to happen, you know. In other words, the explosion and the riots, look, more people died in the year before with no fanfare, you know, than died in the riots, actually. You know, if you really look at the death statistics of Los Angeles, you know, things like that are amazing, you know, when you really look at the real numbers, the real, you know, things like that. So for me, or things happen, sure, because people say, wait a minute, this can't be. And so there started to be more integration and jobs. There were no black people teaching at USC, at Rutgers either, but that's East. at UCLA, at UC Santa Barbara and stuff. Well, I got two job offers on a September day in 1965. One from the University of California at Santa Barbara, and I just had my one-man show there, and so they were aware of my work. Luckily, I had completed my finding that Spanish class that I never took. And so I'm with Professor Gutierrez, who had just come from Cuba. So as he put it, he was learning English as we were learning Spanish. But anyway, so I got my BFA degree that June. Well, then the riots happened in August. And then in September, I got two job offers, one from Chouinard and one from UC Santa Barbara. I got the one from Santa Barbara in the morning, so I accepted because I could teach 1 hour a day for every day of the week, but only 1 hour a day, and I was working 40 hours a day and no time to make art except after 6 o'clock. So I said, yeah. I got home that evening, and there's a call from Chouinard. So, well, that was right in town, I took Chouinard, you know, and I had already told the people of Santa Barbara yes, so I had to explain, you know, and they were not happy that I turned them down, but you go from having no choices to two, you got to make one or the other.
What was L.A. like building up?
L.A. was L.A., you wouldn't know L.A. then, but it wasn't that L.A., it was more segregated as a city. See, in the North, the difference is things are not segregated by law for the most part. That's always been the case. It's segregated by custom and by manipulation, you know, by wealth. It's just like how wealthy people keep other people out of their neighborhoods right now. But it's not based necessarily on color, but it's based on race. I mean, it's based on money. But if you see how many people have significant money, the racial thing still, that consequence is still there. Because the consequences of slavery are that people who are descendants of slaves significantly have less money than people who aren't. You know, I don't mean that all white people are rich. That certainly isn't true, you know. I always say the reason white people knew how to, from England, I'll just use England as the example, know how to oppress black people is they oppressed white people before they got to America, you know. And if you go to England and see how the British upper class treats the British lower class, you might have some thoughts like mine, you know. Okay, my closest neighbor for most of, once I was married and had a family, the first artistic close neighbor was a designer named Bob Rogers. who was a graduate of UCLA and a generation older than me. And his place was on 6th Avenue at Washington Boulevard. And I lived in a little house in the alley between 5th and 6th Avenue. I was there for about a year. I had left school, so I'm not talking about my school friends. Of the school friends who I was still close to would have been David Lawrence, who's in San Bernardino. And in fact, in 60, I think it was 65, my first experience of teaching, I taught one night class drawing for him at San Bernardino Valley College, and I one night a week. So I finished my job in LA at 5 o'clock, and I drove to San Bernardino on Monday evenings and taught that class, and then I came back. You know, I had no intention of teaching, never thought of myself as the kind of person. I knew I didn't want to teach high school, because that you'd never be an artist from my point of view, because it took too much of your time and energy. But anyway, that was the first experience I had teaching. That was when I organized a show with Bob O'Dowd, Ron Miyashiro, Daniel Johnson, Virginia Jaramillo, Karen Hamry, and David Lawrence, you know. And it was called No on 10. Proposition 10 was a political proposition. And somewhere there's a poster which looks like a ballot.
We have the poster, but...
You found the poster?
Yeah. This is my question. Who organized that exhibition?
Well, I did. Because I was, see... David, it wasn't David's show because it was his, he gave permission because he was the connection at San Bernardino Valley College. David Lawrence and I were housemates when we were going to USC, but he was actually in grad school, you know. He got a master's and he got his first job at San Bernardino, and they immediately made him chair of the department. So he had this night class all of a sudden that he had no teacher for, so that's how I got that job, you know. Then, as I said, when September after the riots, which would have been about a year later, I think, I got the job teaching at Chouinard, you know. And
who else was teaching at Chouinard? Tell us the years.
John Canavier.
I would love to be here all afternoon, but hey. Thank you. You were fantastic.
Well, yeah. Tell us more about No on 10, Yes on 10, and what was 10? Nobody seems to
It was
remember.
Some, yeah, I can't remember what the proposition was. It was some tax based or some influence or effect. I really don't remember. Now I don't remember. I'd have to see the ballot, and maybe that would perk the memory. And if we get the year, you can look into the the voting, because it was an actual proposition, you know, on the ballot of I don't know if it was state or city or both. It wasn't federal. It was California, but I don't know what. Yeah, okay.
Okay, so tell me the years you taught at Chouinard, and who else?
65 and 66. John Canavier, Matsumi Kanemitsu, Ed Reap, was Reap his name? I think so, Edward Reap. What's the man's name? He was a hard edge painter. Hammersley?
Yeah.
Yeah, Frederick Hammersley. The ones that people knew later, Alan Rupersberg, what's her name? Boy, she made sculpture very simple. She still has probably a fairly significant. No, Mary, she came later after the next Chouinard.
Mary Corse,
yeah. As Mary Corse said, well, he didn't teach me anything, but he let me do what I wanted. It was true.
What kind of student was
John Schroeder.
Al Rupersberg played as a student.
I don't remember, except I had a good time with them. I was there at an interesting period for old Chouinard, because Disney had already taken administrative control, but they weren't, you know, you didn't see them, much of them, but, or at least as, and I was a new teacher. They'd never had to set up a welding shop. Richard Hunt would have been my predecessor the year before, because he was in residence at Tamron, and they made him artist in residence for a year. So possibly because he had been involved in welding, but they didn't seem to have any welding set up when I got there. So they gave me the money to take a basement area and turn it into a metal shop. And so I had one room for arc welding, and then maybe four or five stations for oxyacetylene welding. Interesting thing was, most of the students who took welding that first semester were women, which, you know, was an interesting thing, because one, there usually weren't many women students in sculpture, and then welding, so that seemed like they were, and there was, one was from Japan, I think her name was Shintani, Sawako Shintani or something, because I remember because her father was a sculptor in Japan, and her sister was a ceramics artist, and she had a brother who was a sculptor who was in Italy studying with Emilio Greco. And somewhere there was a Man Ray show at the County Museum, and Man Ray came over to Chouinard and gave a talk, because he had been at Chouinard back in the 30s. I don't know if it was teaching or visiting or what, but he knew that behind the paint on one of the walls there was a Siqueiros painting that later had been painted over for, you know, and there were several what would have been considered radical murals by the Mexican muralists.
Tell me about your relationship to Siqueiros' work. Being
a person, getting in California, getting an art education, and being interested in murals, that mural interest started in high school, really, because our teacher, Mrs. Ladner, assigned me and a couple of my classmates to the problem doing a mural. Our murals were about this big, but they were conceptually what a mural would be, and you could have taken them and blown them up large, and they would have made sense. But in Houston at that time was John Biggers, who was a muralist, Afro-American artist who was aware of Mexican muralism, as many artists in the United States were. If you figure this is the 50s, well, anybody who was 45 years old had been a student in the 30s or a young artist in the 30s. So all of that social realism was social interaction, and the Mexican artist influenced artists in the United States. They were one of the biggest influences on abstract expressionism in relation to space and experimental materials. And I had read and understood that Siqueiros had taught a workshop in New York of experimental painting. Pollock was one of the people who studied in that or participated in those workshops. So, and that's known about Pollock. But what I don't think people understood, which I started to understand, was that in the West and the Southwest, it wasn't front page, but it was very much in the essential influence on artists, in a lot of artists. Not always the political aspect, but a lot of time the aesthetic and dynamics, that is, the picturesqueness or the utilization of the image of local people. The things that ordinary people did were significant as subject matter for artists, you know. And that when I got to County Art Institute, what we call Otis now, there were discussions. There was a teacher who taught the philosophy of art. The library there, a total art library, which was a revelation to me. I spent a lot of time in there, and I remember all of a sudden really being very aware of experiment, of data, of, you know, all of those processes. And in my personal life, I was then trying to listen to music, which was advanced. The base of that was jazz, and experimental jazz musicians, as I came across them and came to understand. And at the same time, artists, Siqueiros and the muralists seemed dynamic. And I did a project at County Art Institute, and it's in that photograph of me at school in the retrospective catalog. An architectural wall, which was as much architecture, but it was sculpture as much as painting. At least that was my idea in it. And it came from Siqueiros' sculptural, architectural stuff, you know, and his talking about three dimensions. I didn't ever get to see that stuff for real until I went to Mexico in the 70s when I went to see his Polyforum and that kind of thing. And it's to this day, it still moves me as some of the most significant art made in the 20th century really came in Mexico. I think Mexico is far more important than we in the United States give it credit for. I mean, they always say they're good, but Americans would say Pollock is more important than those people, and I don't think so. I think they gave to him, he didn't give to them,
right.
You know.
Mel, were you going to see live music, and where were you going and who were you seeing?
When I could afford it, because I was a poor person going to school. I had 75 cents to go to the movies at the Westlake Theater, but... Live music, I did go and hear occasionally in the L.A. years, the It Club, that's more the 60s, but John McLean's the It Club, there was the After Midnight Place, oh goodness, I forget what it's called. If you ask me later, I can fill that in. Washington Boulevard, Club La Chris was one I went to. I didn't really go to the bigger concerts, mostly because I didn't have the money.
Did you ever see Gillespie?
Not here in L.A. In New York, I went to the, what's the club in Hermosa Beach, the Lighthouse,
yeah.
Once when he was there. And I made the mistake of not getting in on the first set. And so we were lined up outside and nobody left. So nobody who was outside could get in. He came out, and I remember because he was wearing African clothing, he came out and said hello to people and standing in line. But that was the person in my family who saw the most music was my wife, Jane, because that was very much her world and interest. And she grew up here in L.A. I heard music in Texas, you know, but mostly I had records. Tell you what happened that gave me a sort of a record course in music was my cousins. My cousin who was in the Marine Corps in Camp Pendleton, and he came to my aunt's every weekend, because that was his off time, you know, liberty, and he brought records, and he brought the latest jazz records and stuff. He had the money. My cousin was so good to me. He was a little smaller than me, and he bought civilian clothes a size larger so I could wear them to school and stuff. You know, I mean, you know, so looked. I had clothes, but you know, he got the money for the special things sometimes. Yeah, you know, and.
I want to back up a little bit, and I want to ask about specific exhibitions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was the big open exhibition that everybody...
Can you start by saying the year and the place and everything?
That was Barnsdall Park, and it was a big open, I mean, juried show. It was juried, so you got in it. And it was a painting. I think my sister has a painting now. But it was a quasi-abstract, based out of landscape painting, oil painting, about 50 inches by 35, 6 or something. I'm not sure. Something like that. And, you know, I was legally still a student, but this wasn't work for school. Because I painted in my aunt and uncle's garage my own paintings separate from school, you know, stuff.
Was that the first time your work was exhibited publicly?
That I can remember. Every now and then, one of my aunts would take something to a club meeting, but, you know.
What was the group, the Seekers?
The Seekers was a group of Afro-American artists in L.A. who I got introduced to by one of the models in the schools, Wesley Gale, who was a, Wesley was sort of culture in everything kind of person. He painted a little, you know, you would never call him a fine painter, but he painted a little. He danced, modern dance. He may have done more than that. I don't know. He was a little older than me, so his world wasn't really my world. But he told me about this group of painters who met on Sundays at the home of a painter named Benny Cassell. And what they were a group of Afro-American men, there were no women, who were artists but who worked at the post office or, you know, they did other things. And, you know, in say, that would have been 1958, 59 maybe. Some of them were very good. I can remember the names. Somebody named Savage. Somewhere I have a little booklet with the list of the names. Benny Cassell was a primary one because he also was a disc jockey sometimes. And it kind of fit that people were involved or interested in more than one thing because there was no black exhibition situations. La Cienega hadn't developed for anybody at that point. Say, you know, I think there was a art gallery in the Biltmore Hotel, and you'd go by the window and there'd be a gold frame and a light under it. And otherwise, you went to the museum. That was all. At least that was all that I knew. Or you strolled the windows of Wilshire Boulevard, which was, how will you say, my cultural thing. You know, so I saw Danish modern design or, you know, those kind of things that if you grew up in Houston and you're in Los Angeles now, you see those things. And also, you're now 18, 20, you know, years old, so you're interested in more things, you know. But that was basically the Seekers. And I went to a few meetings, and I think there was a show of the work at some library in the 50s near Slauson, I can't remember, because they really did it. I just gave them my work and they did it. And I know because a couple paintings I never got back. And then I saw one of my paintings because it was from Keith Crown's class at SC. And it was in a beauty shop window, you know, decorating the beauty shop. So Benny Cassell had become a disc jockey as well. Then he disappeared. I haven't seen the names of any of them since that period except for Wesley Gale because he kind of stayed active. He was also a part-time actor in any number of movies. Just one brief moment, you see this face go by. And, oh, that's Wesley, you know.
Where would you get your steel from?
My steel? Two or three places. From around automobile mechanic repair shops. That's why you see certain automobile gear things, because they'd repaired and throwing them out and you could get them. But I would go to scrap steel yards in East LA, I think it's on Santa Fe, or one of the streets over there, and I can't remember the name of the place, but I'd go there with my station wagon and, you know, load up usually early in the morning, 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning. And by the time I'd bought the stuff, and I'd stop on Central Avenue and have breakfast in one of the kind of soul food breakfast restaurants. And there was a bookstore, Gordon's Bookstore, and I would stop in there because it was really focused on African. That's where, say, I bought Freedom Ways magazine and stuff like that. And there was another bookstore like that on Santa Barbara, but it wasn't one that I used. And I used, for instance, I subscribed to Polska magazine, which was a Polish international magazine. But what it gave me, not that I didn't read Polish, but it was in English, you know, or bilingual. But it was an international, culturally focused magazine. And I subscribed to the Liberator magazine, which was a Afro-American political magazine out of New York, you know. And, you know, it had some culture. Its cultural things tended to be more toward writing than, visual art. But it did mention an important Afro-American artist, modern, that I met later. I met a painter named Ed Clark, who was very important modern painter, still is alive. He's in his mid-80s now. He was, people don't talk much about it. It wasn't Frank Stella who was the first shaped canvas painter in that post-abstract expressionist generation. The painter was a man named Edward Clark, an Afro-American painter, showed at the Brada Gallery and the 10th Street Gallery. And artists, you know, they know about, they know that history, you know, if they're of that generation. But all the credit and art economic manipulation went the other way. But Ed was the real first proponent of shaped canvas, not in that simplistic form, because for him, it to change the shape of the canvas was to extend the space of the gesture, you know, that was. But he was mentioned in the Liberator magazine as an Afro-American artist who'd gotten frustrated in New York and had gone to Europe, you know, by the Larry Neal, the poet Larry Neal mentioned him. I never met him and didn't know him. Then somebody mentioned his name to me when I moved to New York. The person who mentioned him to me was another of the artists who'd gone to Europe after World War II, like Ken Nolan, and this was George Sugarman. And he asked me, did I know Ed Clark and what happened to him? And I said, I didn't really know him. I had heard of him, but he wasn't somebody I knew. But he thought because I was Afro-American and knew a significant number of Afro-American artists that I might know, because George had been in Europe. And he said, well, you know, Ed was one of the people we really thought was going to be significant here in the States. Well, nobody would give him a break. That was all it was. In Time magazine in the late 40s or early 50s, in the European version of the magazine, Rauschenberg and Ed Clark had the same kind of status. You know, so that, you know, it tells you something was going on.
Yeah,
you know? Yeah. The reason I remember I mentioned Bob Rogers? Well, Bob Rogers on Fifth Avenue, a clothing designer, clothing maker, and very good one. Charles Lawton wore his clothes, just to throw another plug Bob's way. He's passed away. But I was looking for a job. I had just, you know, left school and my wife was pregnant, and I went to the Urban League. And they said, you know, art, no jobs for art. And then somebody said, wait a minute, what about that Tony Hill guy? Well, Tony Hill was an Afro-American ceramics person who actually had taken ceramics at USC, but that was before, and he's much older, he's my parents' generation. And he was a real intellectual. I didn't know that at the time, but Tony was a real intellectual. Tony had a ceramics business where he made commercial lamps for the kind of Danish modern contemporary furniture design world. And he had a place on Jefferson Boulevard. And they called him and said, look, we have this young man who's an art and da-da-da. And I went over and he interviewed me and he put me to work. And what he did was make these high-fire, high-color Maholika glaze ceramics, modern ceramics, meaning contemporary simple. But he would paint them in these high-color Maholika glaze, low-fire, relatively low. But strong enough. And then we spray them with olive drab and various other colors of lacquer, and then take steel wool and wipe it down so the other color shows through, kind of modern decorative, you know, and match them with beautiful lampshades. And he had a Inga, I can't remember her last name, but a lady who made handcrafted the lampshades. And he did two shows in the East, I think Chicago, twice a year. And so I worked for him for at least a year. And my job was the steel wool on the ceramics. I kept trying to get him to let me make a few really adventurous, because I was still painting, you know, ceramic units that were all paintings. But he wasn't ready. But then Tony one day said, look, says, I've got this little showroom in near Sunset, Beverly Hills. And it's a room about as big as the area we are in here. And there's this artist a painter, and you got some of that sculpture that you're doing now. Why? So I'm going to do a little show of you. Well, I never, you know. So anyway, that artist was John Outerbridge. Okay, well, Outerbridge was just out of the Army, and I'm sure the paintings he was showing in that show, he would never show. I've never seen him since. And Outerbridge became a good friend, but I won't even put the words on camera because he's a dear friend. John became a much better artist after that. But John had just come from he'd been in the service. I don't know how many years he'd been in Germany. He had a Mercedes-Benz because they were very cheap in Germany then, and if you brought a used one back in the U.S., you know. They were so rare, nobody knew they were special because it wasn't the kind that was in Esquire magazine with the butterfly doors. This was just the box of a car, you know. But John, it was him, and so that's how we met, you know. But I already knew Ron. Ron Miyashiro was living next door. Danny Johnson was a friend because we'd met when he was at Chouinard and I was at County Art Institute. I met his wife when she and I were in an exhibition at the County Museum, which was about 1960 or 61, right in there. I would say 61, I think. And he's the one who introduced me to Ron Miyashiro, and they introduced me to Ed Burrell, you know, so that was that way. Marvin Harden was already my friend. David Lawrence was a friend. And then through Danny, I started Danny, because he was the more socially aggressive person of Ronnie and he and I. And so I would go to openings or I met people on La Cienega. I would say his Chouinard connections. You know, I had the sports life, another life before, whereas they had always been in art. In art school, people were already in the art world of LA, you could say. So that was different for me. So it was a part of probably why I was a bit more independent in certain ways. Some of it I just didn't, you know, I just psychologically wasn't a part of, you know.
Did you go to like the Ferris shows or Nick Wilde
I went to, yeah, Wilder's came, by the time Wilder came, I was going. And Ferris, I would go to. I wasn't that impressed. I still don't care for Warhol much. I mean, I understand and appreciate, but care for, no. You know, so Ferris wasn't showing much that I wasn't interested in, but I understood that in the scheme of what was going on in art, it had a dynamic place. Dwan, I probably paid more attention to Dwan by 65, 66.
And can you tell us the jobs that you did with her?
With Dwan?
Yeah,
I didn't work at them, but what I did was the Tingleys, the kinetic sculpture. Ron Miyashiro worked for Dwan. He actually worked for them. By then, I was already teaching at Chouinard. This had been 65, 66. And Ron, for instance, was making the Robert Morris sculpture. When Robert Morris came out to do a show at Dwan, he gave the design to Ron. So they were being made right next door to where I live. So I saw him. Robert Grosvenor came, and he had a large ceiling piece, and Ronnie made it next door. So and that's how I met Grosvenor, you know, that kind of thing. I met Morris, but we didn't become friends. I just met him. Flavin.
What did you do for the
Tingley? Okay, the Tingley, Jack Tingley had done a group of sculpture for Dwan Gallery 1 year. I guess it would have been 65. And left them in a garage or some storage place. And Dwan wanted to show them, but they weren't working. And Ron, he told Ron, I guess, Miyashiro, and Ron said, oh, Mel can do it. Ron didn't know. All I could do was fix my bicycle. I wasn't a mechanic. But anyway, I went and looked at them, and he'd assembled the pieces, but he hadn't attached the motors or the switches for activating the motors. Well, that wasn't too complicated a thing to do. And so I did that. I prepared, in essence, made functional the whole show of Tingley sculpture. And so it was a nice introduction to, here's a sculptor who works in metal and the stuff is kinetic. And I made it work. When I moved to New York, Dwan had closed in L.A., and they moved to New York. And then there was, Dwan was sending some Tingleys for an exhibition at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago. So they asked me to, go to Chicago with them and make them, that they're functional. So I did. The director in Chicago was Jan Vandermark at the time and stuff. So because of that, and I was new in New York and occasionally needed work, the word got out that I was a specialist in repairing kinetic sculpture. So Lefebvre Gallery, who handled Paul Bury, and Bury's, of course, are just the opposite of Tingley's, and looking very shiny and sophisticated. Inside, they were no more complex than the Tingleys. And just like Tingley looked a lot more complicated than they were. Because if they'd truly been complicated, I wouldn't have been the person capable of doing it. But it gave me extended my interest in kinetic things. And in part, I would say, seeing them, those kinetic things, and spending time thinking about them. And also Singh Calder's, because Calder made a piece in Los Angeles at the time. But I didn't want to make work that was like theirs, so in New York I developed the rockers, you know. But it was a way of having pieces that moved, but the principle of kinetic, you know, kinetics and balance, if you will. Rolf Nelson was just one of the galleries we went to, like Wilder, like Ferris, like, you mentioned Ferris earlier. The person whose work I saw at Ferris, the most was the assemblage guy, keynotes. You know, those shows I saw that. And, you know, and since I was teaching at Chouinard in 65 and 66, I was recommending that my students go to those shows and, you know, see anything that was recent, contemporary and stuff, you know.
Did you ever run across keynotes in a junkyard?
No, no, we wouldn't have, okay, that's it. See, I lived in the black part of L.A. I didn't live wherever, I don't know where Keno's lived, but I knew he didn't live where I lived. Danny Johnson lived in a black part of Los Angeles. That's where, as I say, in the north, you know, the separation or communities where people lived. I mean, I had white artists who were my friends and we visited each other and stuff. Also different than New York, L.A. is very big. So you drove a long way to see somebody, no matter who it was, it could be. But in the case of Danny Johnson, Ron Mishiro and I, and Marv Hardin lived in first Watson and Compton, Burrell lived on Venice near Western, and Danny lived on Brighton, I think near Western, yeah, the other side of Western. And I lived on near Arlington and Van Ness, you know. So we lived within 5-10 minutes drive of each other. Whereas if I wanted to see Arthur Secunda, he lived the other, you know, Silver Lake or the over, you know, further away. So we did see each other. And since I worked in Hollywood, you know, in the film companies, and was at Tamron and places like that. And I met Bob Dowd because I think he was working in an art supply store. You know, just you met people at, I met Judy Gurewitz, who later became, you know, Judy Chicago, when she and Gurewitz were married because Marv Hardin and I drove out to the canyons to take a walk in the landscape because Marv and I would go and look at landscape, to drawing, and that was a part of his work. For me, it was more looking at the kind of things I could find that had to do with form, but not drawing or them, just, you know, looking. But Judy Gurewitz lived in the canyon at that point with her husband, and so that's how I met them, because they were UCLA people, and I didn't know them. I knew Marv went to UCLA, but they weren't people I knew. As I said, just like Chouinard, because I had close friends who had gone to Chouinard and who lived nearby, Ed, Danny, and Ronnie, then, you know, they were kind of my entry in, you might say, you know,
okay,
that
so
way.
Did you ever go to the studios like Robert O'Dowd or Judy Chicago?
No, Judy, and she wasn't Chicago then. She was still Gurewitz. Lloyd Hamrell also was at UCLA. They were people who know them. I didn't. David Lawrence's studio, you know, because David would have been friends. Arthur Secunda, I would have known his work. There's a print you might check with Arthur in Scottsdale, because he sent me a copy of it based on the riots in LA, and he used part of my face from that photograph from my first one-man show with events, photographic events, collage from the, and he showed it in Sweden, you know, and some prints, because I gave him photographs and stuff. You know, as I said, I had been documented a few things.
Did you see the War Baby? Did you know about the War Baby?
I saw the poster. I didn't know them at the time. And then when I met Ronnie and then Eddie, I knew two of them. Then I met Joe Good, but I didn't really get to know Joe Good. Larry, I might have had a drink with him and Irwin and Danny or somebody, but that was it. You know, Larry, my brother got to know Larry Bell later, but that was afterwards. And I never had. The second time I saw Larry Bell was in Taos, New Mexico, at his studio there, 1991. So of the War Babies, Rani and Eddie. And Rani, because he lived next door, was the closest. But I saw the poster and thought that was interesting when I saw it in 59 or whatever year it was. Yeah, you know. And when I then got to know him, I just laughed and said, yeah, well.
Okay, tell me, what was Ralph Nelson like? What kind of work did he show? And then will you describe the radio piece?
I can't remember. I think O'Dowd showed with him, but I'm not sure. Don't quote me for sure. Look it up. But I did go to shows, and maybe if you showed me a list of shows, I could tell you better what I saw and didn't see. But I do remember his was a place to go, you know, of that and CJ, because Marvin Harden showed at CJ and a couple of other people. I remember Rolf's is interesting, but that show was a thematic show, like artists and their something from the popular world. You might say the presence of pop art was probably the theme for whoever suggested it. And I probably was connected with it through Danny Johnson. That's my recollection. And if I remember right, Danny Johnson showed a carton of Archie Moore milk, you know, which, you know, we were always heavyweight champion. There had been a Joe Louis milk for a while, while Archie Moore was a champ right in that period, a very important fighter. And he was out of San Diego, so he was Californian, and Danny is a real Californian, not me, so. But anyway, Danny showed a carton of that. And my idea was this radio, which only produced static, and a screw eye hook large into the wall above it, which had a heavy cord with like a hangman's noose, which had a stone in it, which was more phallic shaped, you know, but it was just a natural stone. From the beach, because it had certain kind of holes in it, and it was suspended just above this. I think it was a Philco radio, one of that plastic style of curved radios. And clearly what it was a battery had gone bad or something. And I just, it was an old radio, I think in my uncle's garage. Suspended the stone above it. What I noticed was, because I could only get static out of it, was if you kind of pushed the stone and it moved, it altered the static a little bit. I don't know who else noticed it when it was being shown, because I didn't demonstrate, you know. But it was in my interest, sound. I would record sounds from the radio and stuff, because when I worked for Dwan and the money I got from repairing the Tingleys, I bought a tape recorder so I could tape and mix tapes, put sounds together. And I still have a bunch of those old tapes. Still have that tape recorder. Yeah, this is pre-resistor, so it's about this big. And it lay down, and we had two different speeds. And I would tape tapes together. You might say I peeped over the shoulder of a couple of the people in the studios when I was, the animation studios, is how they edited and taped stuff together. So I figured out how to make a loop on my own and stuff like that. So,
you still have those tapes?
I still have some.
Listen,
yeah,
to them ever?
I haven't in a long time, but
great to do that.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Really,
actually, one of them got taken for a film. A man who had been an animation photographer in those same studio days, named Fred Wellington, made a film in New York. He moved to New York also. And he made this film of a woman walking around as if she was the only person in these old buildings in New York without anybody else around. And I think Judy was her name. And he had tried to get some music from someone else, well, I would say music from a real musician. And I guess in his frustration, I probably played some of the kind of tape collages. I would collage sound from the radio, from records, and record them at one speed and play the other speed. But anyway, mix them. So he said, look, can I use one of your tape things for this film? So he said it won a prize at the Trieste Film Festival. But the film's called Judy, and the man's name was Fred Wellington. He left New York, and I heard he sort of just stepped outside of art and everything. I think he had personal problems to deal with. But I recently had telephone contact with his son, and Fred's somewhere in California. And I would, because I never got a copy of the film. So, and I can't be sure of the tape that I have, which was used, that I used for that, or he, I gave to him to use for that.
Those tapes are remarkably stable over time.
Well, I've been told yes and no today on that.
Yeah.
Will you tell me about the two jobs that you had at the various film companies?
At Graphic Film Company, that's run by a man named, founded and directed and run by Lester Novros, N-O-V-R-O-S. If you know the painter David Novros, that's his father. And David was, as I was leaving, as he was just coming in, but I think we took maybe the night sculpture class together under George Baker when I went back. And I had just been fired from a job at Los Angeles County Hospital and mentioned it to David, and he said, well, maybe my father needs somebody. And turned out he did, and I became the driver delivery person, sort of all around, you know. And so I worked there for a year, maybe 2 years. And they were doing very interesting things. And the really good thing about working there was everybody there was an artist from art school and, you know, things like that. And were my age or a little older. Most are a little older. And a couple of very experienced people were in their 50s and stuff like that. And animation in that period was very hand, functional. And so people did a variety of jobs, and it was an interesting place. Ben Jackson was one of the director animators, Dietrich Friesen, Conrad Peterson, Terry Nowak was, and Peter Van Dusen were the editors of film. And the man I mentioned about the other making the film, Fred Wellington, he ran a camera service not far away. When they had excess or special work, they sent it to him, and that was how I met him, you know. In fact, Artist Secret, the piece, the lifted X, you know, the lower geometric section, that was Fred Wellington's structure for his camera. It was much more to it, but he had this steel that he, when he, as he was closing his shop, he asked me, would I like some steel? I said, yeah.
Were you going to see films, and what kind of films?
Oh yeah, mostly foreign films. In fact, I almost didn't go see American films in the late 50s, early 60s. The Vagabond Theater was where I went, and of course the Brigitte Bardot films and stuff, but last year at Marion Bad, I remember that because that was challenging aesthetically for me. I didn't understand why somebody would make a film like that. But at Graphic Films, every morning practically, when I brought in the coffee and donuts, the donuts from the helmsman, because he came through the alley, my job was to get the donuts. So we'd talk about film and things like that. And so we had discussions that were like, talked about Pauline Kael and the film critics and what people were saying about, you know. It's like taking a film course in a way. I'm trying to remember, what was he? Renoir, the filmmaker, you know, his films, the Swedish filmmaker, Bergman, a lot of the Bergman had seen Wild Strawberries. You know, all of this is right in that period. Oh goodness, the Russian film Ballad of a Soldier. That just, to this day, that move, that's a moving film, you know. Foreign films, you know, Paths of Glory, Kirk Douglas. That was an American film that I did see, you know, against the idea of war, you know.
The Vagabond
was on Wilshire, right next door to the old County Art Institute, right near Carondelet and Wilshire, if Carondelet comes through there, or Westlake, you know, anyway, right in there, you know.
I think we almost covered everything.
Yeah. The other thing I was saying is there were theater things. Leroy Jones's The Toilet came and played. James Baldwin's play, what was the name of that film? I mean, drama. One of James Baldwin's, I remember because Baldwin was here in LA for B. Richards was in it. Oh, goodness. I can't remember. Oh, and Janae's The Blacks. Ivan Dixon, who became my friend, were two people in Hollywood people who got interested in my work. Ivan Dixon, who bought my sculpture and gave it as a gift to Charles White. And Charles wouldn't hang it up on the wall. That was, well, I told you the story. But, and Davis Roberts, who was an older actor. In fact, he was an acting teacher as well, because my sister and my wife were in some of his workshops studying theater. But my sister didn't end up in acting, but as an administrator for the Screen Actors Guild for many years till she retired a couple of years ago.
Did you come to know Amiri Baraka? Did you?
In since I got to New York, in the old days I didn't know him. No, I know him very well. We have a great, great teasing relationship. Because I said he's the oldest man that ever wrote.
Sure, he loved that.
He's that starts, you know. If I'm somewhere and I haven't seen it, he's there, I will hear a loud noise talking about old people in the distance. And I would do the same to him. So I don't, Kelly hasn't seen me and her father in each other's presence very often, or she'd know a different side of both of us.
That's right. I think that's it.
Okay.
This was really great.
Since we started and ended on Amiri Baraka, he's much older than me.
For the record.
For the art historical record.
Well, we got it on tape now.
No, but I would say this part, which is the other thing, it's since L.A., but it came out of L.A. relationship, and that is the poet Jane Cortez, who is my wife, was very active. She created the first theater group, the Watts Theater Workshop. Not the Watts the writers thing with, what's his name? But a separate theater group before the riots had happened. I think they were called the Watts Repertory Theater. They were doing things, Janae and, you know, and their own invented plays and stuff. And so we met at Bob Rogers because the political thing, when you asked a question earlier about politics, and I was trying to explain that it just was there, whether you were directly involved. I wasn't directly involved in SNCC. She was, you know, in fact, in that period was when we vaguely met. I mean, we had separate lives, so I'm not talking about us in the sense of together, but how the, what was going on with the artists was going on with the painters, going with the people interested in literature and stuff like that. And for instance, Tony Hill called me one day and said, look, the president of Senegal is going to be here at a reception and I want you to come as one of our art people. And so I had, I went and bought a suit. And this is, I think, 66, after the first Festival of Black Art in Senegal. And Ivan Dixon, who won like the prize for acting in that, was there. Well, we were friends. And this, there was an interrelatedness in the arts, you know, and our, basically in this talk, mostly I'm speaking of how it was in relation in the black community, you know, that I lived in and stuff. But there were other relationships and other people. One of the first collectors of my work was a man named Richard Tufeld, who was an announcer and on television for commercials and stuff. He owned a piece that I named after Ingmar Bergman's The Dance of Death at the end of that film, if you know Wild Strawberries, and they kind of dance. Well, there's a, rare that there's a piece of mine in bronze, but I welded a little bronze piece that he bought. Freelance dealer around the arts. There was an Afro-American painter named Wilbur Haney. I don't know if his name's ever come up, but Haney showed at a fairly prominent gallery near Wilder, but I can't think of its name. It was a bit more, if Wilder's more the cutting edge, you know, kind of gallery, it's a bit more pretty commercial kind of gallery. Bernie, was it Bernie Casey? He showed there, whatever that gallery was. Somebody from that period will know. But Biana Naya, Palmer, Fagan Palmer Gallery, wasn't there a Fagan? Yeah, there's a Fagan Palmer Gallery. And she would organize benefit things or something for the Democratic Party. She was sort of an old timer from the days of the architect Schindler. In fact, somebody said she may have been his girlfriend in an earlier time. But she probably is not living now. I haven't heard of her name in some years, but she was an older lady, you know, moving around in the art world.
And she collected your work?
She didn't collect it, she tried to sell it, but she and I ultimately, how you say it, I liked the lady for herself, but I didn't fit well in that kind of, let me try to do this, let me try to do that with your work. And, I would say she was an interesting kind of person for me to meet because she was of an older generation at the time, and that told me what the arts had been like in LA in the period. And, she just was a part of things. You know how you meet people and they don't fit you in this way or that way, but they fit information and stuff. Sam Locke wrote sitcoms for TV, I don't know which, and he bought one, possibly two pieces of mine, but you know, if you know some people in the television writing world who are in their 70s or 80s, they might know who Sam Locke is.
And how did you come to know Dr. Banks?
Well, he was a local baby doctor. Danny Johnson knew him first, and I had babies. And it turned out Dr. Banks took care of all of it, so he owns significant amounts of sculpture and stores on his. But he was the first of the significant black collectors. I still, he's the only one I know in LA anyway. But my twins were needles, and
he'd give me, you know, cases of Enfamil, which is baby milk. And, you know, I didn't live that far from his office. And, you know, when my daughters had health problems, little plus one had a...
born with a kind of hernia situation. And so, you know, he told me when to take her to the hospital and stuff.
You
and
collected lots of different California artists.
Yeah, but in that period, let's say among the people that I knew, he didn't do a lot of collecting, but it was good stuff.
Maybe later on.
Danny, Rani, well, he kept doing it. Yeah. And I left in 67. It's okay.
All right, good. Well, I think we're all set. Okay. This has really been great.
Yeah, me too.
Everything that I wanted to
Yeah, okay, yeah.
A lot more.
Yeah, well, that's life. There's always.